Bom dia a todos.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. It is a great pleasure to kick off our second international seminar on disinformation and elections, organized here at the Superior Election Court under the coordination of our General Secretariat, Professor Aline Osorio. This is one of the defining topics of our time. We are now living through digital revolution and technical revolution that has transformed our lives and the mode as how we make purchases and how we listen to music. This brought a lot of comfort and commodities, but also it brought some risks for of which we need to be prepared to. Risks associated to the artificial intelligence, risks associated to genetic data, risk for the privacy of people, and also, unfortunately, risks for democracy. Internet democratized the access to information, access to knowledge, and the access to the public space, which evidently would be virtues that we need to celebrate. Unfortunately, therefore, the internet and the social media and the personal blogs also have opened some space to hate, disinformation, and the theories of conspiracy that lots of times represent a risk, which is a relevant risk to the democracies. And to start our seminar, reflecting more precisely over the topic, the impact of disinformation in democratic processes, the Superior Election Court has the pleasure to receive here Professor Lawrence Lessig, who is the Royal Furman Professor of Right and Leadership in Law School at Harvard. He's the author of several books, including They Don't Represent Us, Reclaiming Our Democracy, and also Fidelity and Constraint, How the Supreme Court Has Read the American Constitution. Lessig is the founder of Equal Citizens and the member of the Founding Council of Creative Commons and works in the Scientific Council of Access Research Fund. He has a title of Bachelor in Arts and Bachelor in Science from the University of Pennsylvania. He has a master from Cambridge University, and he is a Juris Doctor from Yale Law School. He's been assistant of two important American justices, Richard Posner, very well known in Brazil, by references to economic analysis of rights, of law, and pragmatism, and the Justice Antonin Scalia has already died from the American Supreme Court. Professor Lessig, é um grande prazer tê-lo aqui conosco. Professor Lessig, a palavra é sua.
Thank you very much, and I'm grateful obrigado. For the chance to speak. I wish I could be there in person.
De aqui com vocês, os que gostaria de estar aí pessoalmente.
Only I owe you a trip and I'm eager to Brasil, deliver on my obligations.
I have
a presentation I wanted to make. There are many slides in the presentation and it's hard to synchronize them, so I'm using Zoom.
So I've recorded the presentation and I'm going to play it now and then I'll come back afterwards and continue the conversation. So thank you again. Nosso bate-papo, okay? Muito obrigado mais uma vez. Então, no 13 de setembro, o Wall Street Journal começou a publicar uma série de artigos chamados Arquivos Facebook, Facebook Files, e Facebook Files foram baseados em documentos lançados para o Wall Street Journal por denunciador do Facebook. E duas semanas depois, no 60 Minutes, ela se identificou como Frances Haugen, e dois dias depois disso, Frances Haugen testemunhou no Congresso americano sobre o que o Facebook sabia sobre a forma que a tecnologia estava afetando a sociedade e a nossa democracia. E nessa semana, no dia 25, centenas de artigos já foram então publicados por todo mundo baseado no consórcio que tem visto os mesmos documentos que o Congresso agora tem. Então, eu estou atualmente representando uma Frances Haugen com capacidade limitada, e eu não quero falar sobre as especificidades do caso, mas eu acho que o caso dela realmente nos dá uma oportunidade para pensarmos o que, que isso pode nos ensinar. Essas revelações sobre a democracia, ou vamos dizer, sobre a era digital democracia. O que, que podemos aprender disso? Porque eu tenho medo de que o que, que nós podemos aprender desses documentos, arquivos, dessas histórias que foram reveladas, não é nada bom. Que nós estamos, de fato, bom, nós devemos considerar sermos um ponto de equilíbrio na nossa cultura e na nossa democracia. E se os governos não agirem agora e não agirem rapidamente, nós podemos perder a oportunidade de respondermos a essas ameaças das plataformas digitais representam. Agora, temos muitas diferentes plataformas digitais, algumas são dominantes, muitas outras existem além dessas plataformas dominantes, e essas plataformas são apresentadas a nós como se fossem plataformas de... onde nós podemos ser livres, liberdade de falarmos o que quisermos. E claro que elas têm essa liberdade. E isso leva, pelo menos para algumas, que essas plataformas sejam não reguláveis, porque elas são constitucionalmente protegidas, protegidas pela liberdade de... Uma coisa que eu gostaria de ter a atenção de vocês aqui é que essa conclusão não avança. Eu gostaria de ver porque isso vai demandar algum trabalho, e esse é o trabalho que eu vou focar aqui. Nós temos plataformas que são locais onde as pessoas conseguem dizer as coisas que quiserem dizer por causa da liberdade de expressão, e eles caracterizam esforços para regularem essas plataformas com o governo entrando e identificando essas mensagens que talvez não sejam justas, que poderiam ser, entre aspas, censura. Mas essa imagem aqui não é muito correta do que essas plataformas representam. Nós podemos pensar disso como se fosse a Rev 1 sobre o que essas plataformas são. Essas plataformas, na verdade, elas não são apenas locais onde a expressão pode acontecer livremente. Elas são plataformas onde podem ser suprimidas e amplificar a expressão das pessoas baseado no qual expressão ou fala seja mais produzido, mais lucrativa ou melhor para as plataformas. Mas então as plataformas dizem, bom, se nós estamos num negócio de amplificarmos a expressão, então isso não faz nenhuma diferença de um site como o New York Times. E é claro que vai decidir quais artigos estarão na parte de cima and that choice too, they say, is protected by free speech principles. But once again, I want to say not quite. Because these choices made by newspapers, are different from the choices made by these digital platforms. Because the digital platforms' choices about which content to prioritize are not choices by humans, they are choices by machines. And I want to argue that that difference should matter to constitutional jurisprudence, even if it does not yet matter in the context of the United States. Okay, so to understand what these platforms are doing, we have to start with the pretty obvious fact. These platforms are businesses. And these businesses have business models, ways they intend to make money. And these business models depend upon increasing the attention that we give to them. And this increased attention means increased intelligence that these platforms have about us. And this increased intelligence that they have about us means they're able to engage in better targeting of advertisement to us. And better targeting means that they will earn more revenue from the ads which they sell to product suppliers, and that more revenue will mean more profit for those platforms. So the objective of these platforms is to increase our attention. And these platforms therefore do this by exploiting, and I want that word to be emphasized, exploiting our weaknesses as humans. They understand us, they understand our weaknesses, and they manipulate us
to get us hooked or addicted or dependent on their content so that we stay on their platforms and come back to their platforms for more and more attention given to them. Now, of course, not just them, or we could say this is not the first time that businesses have had an incentive to find a way to capture or to addict us. If we think about humans as bodies, we can talk about the way these bodies get hacked. And by hacked, I mean taken over by systems of intelligence with alien purpose to us, or at least alien purpose to you. Call this body hacking. Here's an example. Think about food. And by food, I mean not food like this, or this, or this. Instead, I mean food like this, or this, or this, or this. Or take the best example, we call these buffalo wings. Behold the buffalo wings, which are a perfect mixture of salt, sugar, and fat, perfectly mixed to make them almost addictive to people who consume them. Some might think of this as a miracle, and it is a miracle in the sense that Tide washing machine substance is a miracle. By a miracle, I mean then a choice, a design choice, made by scientists, food scientists, or we could call them food architects, working in laboratories to fix the mix of salt, fat, and sugar to make the product as addictive as it can be. Michael Moss, in his book, Salt, Sugar, Fat, describes the emergence of this food science, which is a science to engineer food to overcome our natural resistance to the food so we cannot stop eating this food. Okay, that's what I mean by body hacking, exploiting evolution with an aim. And what is the aim? Obviously, the aim is to make money. Now, for some, that hacking is harmless. There are plenty of perfectly healthy people who eat even terrible food. But for others, of course, it is not harmless. This food targeted to them is extremely harmful. And they know that these people can't resist, but they build their business based on this inability to resist. Indeed, the most striking part of this book's story is the story of companies coming to realize how their products are actually harmful to their customers. And then certain executives within the processed food industry deciding that they will take steps to minimize the harmfulness of their products, only to have the products be less appealing to the public, and that less appealing product therefore becomes less profitable to the companies, and the companies quickly learn to give up their hope to produce healthy processed food, and these executives are quickly moved out of positions of executive control. The companies are constrained. They say the market made us do it, but that's because the business model of their business makes them vulnerable to our weakness. That's body hacking. Now, we can think of an equivalence which we could call brain hacking. Tristan Harris, former Google engineer who started the Center for Humane Technology, writes about the science, which is the science of Silicon Valley, to engineer our attention to overcome a resistance that we might have to digital technologies. Not a resistance of our bodies, but our brains. And the means here are exactly the same. These digital engineers are exploiting evolution, the fact that we have evolved to be especially sensitive to random rewards, or it's impossible for us to resist bottomless pits of content. These are just ways we have evolved, and the technology companies exploit that to overcome our resistance and to therefore addict us to their products, with the aim, obviously, just like as before, to make money. Now, they do this mainly from ads, not just from ads, but mainly from ads. And it's important to remember that ads are relatively new in the life of the internet. Sergey Brin and Larry Page, when they launched Google, declared that advertising-funded search engines will be inherently biased towards the advertisers and away from the needs of the consumers. But then they quickly realized that unfunded search engines would be biased against Google's investors. So then they had a brilliant, if evil, idea to launch a business based on what Shoshana Zuboff has called surveillance capitalism. And what surveillance capitalism resolves is that these companies engage in the business of spying on their users. But I don't mean spying in the traditional passive sense, where they sit back and watch what their users do, but in sense spying in the sense of collecting the digital exhaust as people move across the sites and across the internet. You could think of these as mouse droppings that remains as we reveal ourselves, as we engage with content on the internet. And these mouse droppings, this digital exhaust, these things are collected to better understand what users want, but not just simply by watching, not just by a passive consumption of information about what we want, but instead by actively poking and tweaking and asking us questions, rendering us vulnerable by reaching down the brain stack to leverage our insecurity so we engage and share more. This is what Instagram and Facebook have been revealed to do in the Facebook files that the Wall Street Journal has been writing about. As they increasingly deploy techniques they know will drive people to consume more content, even if those techniques include revealing information that they know will make their customers worse off. So we do mouse droppings more, and they therefore see more so that their ads can sell more or sell better. Now the point is, here too, they're simply exploiting features of us, us humans, to give them power to induce us to give them what they need. And what they need, of course, is designed to make them rich. It makes the internet possible. People like Mark Zuckerberg will say, therefore, it's win-win. They get the data, we get the free internet. Except it's not win-win. Because, of course, there are unintended consequences. At least let's hope that they are unintended. Unintended consequences, which are the side effects of surveillance. Now, these consequences are significant for individuals, as individuals find themselves addicted to these platforms. And for some vulnerable individuals, that addiction is quite destructive. Data has demonstrated the rise, perfectly correlated to the rise of these platforms in teen suicide, especially among young girls, where suicide has tripled over the period that digital platforms have become dominant, but not just for individuals, for society. And this in the United States was drawn home for us by the extraordinary insurrection that we saw at the beginning of this year, based upon the belief that at least half in the Republican Party have of an absolute lie, the lie that the election was stolen by Joe Biden against Donald Trump. That belief, which there is no evidence to support at all, is currently believed by more than half of Republicans. Indeed, more than half of Republicans say that there is, quote, clear evidence that the platforms, that clear evidence that this election was stolen. And that belief was helped to be spread by these platforms, leading to insane and destructive acts of many across the nation. Because as this machine spreads its information, it does so selectively, this machine. We should recognize it is a highly sophisticated artificial intelligence machine engaged in the project of manipulating us. We should think of it as a manipulation engine, figuring out how it can feed us what will trigger us to behave in ways that they want us to behave. Manipulation engine, we could abbreviate ME, let's call them monster MEs. And as the monster ME selectively amplifies and suppresses content, its choice has an effect on citizens, especially has an effect for democracy. Because unfortunately, the best, as in most profitable strategy for democracy, the best surveillance capitalism strategy in the domain of citizens is to play the politics of hate. They profit more the more polarized and ignorant the public is, the more angry and emotional and false its beliefs are, the more engaged and passionate and willing to engage we become. So it's better than factual or pleasant or truths that are true. These emotional, false, and misleading content leads people to engage much more substantially, which means much more profitably for the platforms. So this is a business model driven, a business model committed to making us stupid. Because making us stupid, making us ignorant, making us react in an emotional, angry way is the best way to make us engage in their platforms. And that means engage in a way that makes them more money. Now, this is true not just of the internet. In the United States, of course, we've moved, as every nation around the world has, from primarily focusing on broadcast television to increasingly focusing on cable television. And as that has happened, the cable news networks have begun to evolve. And they have evolved in an ideologically determined way. The three major cable news networks in the United States right now are CNN, MSNBC, and Fox News. And these three networks have evolved in the ideological content that they offer across their broadcasts. So in 2000, studies to measure the ideological content found no real difference between these three networks. But over the course of the 2000s, the character of these networks changed dramatically as these networks moved more and more into ideological corners, so that now Fox News is clearly understood to be a conservative news outlet that tells stories that their base wants to hear, and MSNBC has been understood to be a liberal news outlet that tells stories that their base wants to hear, but that as people are educated on these radically different stories about the way the world is, that can't help but build the polarizing and ignorant character of much of American politics. These are business models that profit from harming us in our democratic roles. Now, the link here between body hacking and brain hacking should be obvious. Both of these are just business models. They're just ways for corporations to make money. And both of them have consequences. Consequences for those who consume each of these products. And what pays them in both contexts, what makes them more money, weakens us, specifically weakens our health, our physical health, our social health, and our political health. And it makes them less profitable for them if they were to make us anything other than less healthy as they have done. So is it any surprise that if they profit from making us unhealthy, we are unhealthy? Is it any surprise that the food we eat or the information about politics that we consume drive us to these extremes? Okay, so these facts lead people to wonder, can anything be done? And one reason people fear that nothing can be done is the consequence of what I want to call free speech extremism. Because the free speech extremists say, no, there's nothing you can do. That the selective amplifying and suppressing of speech, which these platforms do as they spread messages across digital platforms, is speech. And that speech can't be regulated because the principles of free speech say, we have to protect the ability of newspapers, for example, like the New York Times, to choose which content gets prioritized. And so therefore, we have to protect the ability of Facebook to choose which content gets spread broadly. Okay, but here's the mistake in that thinking. When the New York Times engages in this important project of selectively choosing which content will be presented, that selection is done by humans. And humans have rights. They, as humans, have a right of free speech. But Facebook, the company, or Facebook, the machines that are prioritizing or not, are not humans. Monster me's more generally, monster manipulation engines more generally, are not humans. And what we need to evolve is a recognition that these machines should not be seen as having rights, that the fact that they happen to speak with words should not render their actions unregulable any more than if they spoke by spewing forth drugs which addicted us because of their effect on our system should not render them unregulable. That we have to develop a capacity for understanding why principles of free speech matter and make sense in the context of protecting the democratic deliberation of humans, whether we like what they say or not, but not in the context of these highly sophisticated machines. And if we can't make that distinction, if we lose the ability to draw a line between places where the free speech principle guarantees people can engage without government censorship, and places where the free speech principle does not guarantee that machines can't engage without the fear of government regulation. If we can't make that distinction, I fear we are lost. Because if we can't make that distinction, we won't be able to regulate these emerging sophisticated technologies of manipulation, these AI machines, as they regulate us for the purposes they themselves have identified, regardless of the harm they impose on us or on society or democracy. If we can't regulate them, then we will be stuck in this train that we can't get off as we guarantee to them the capacity to engage with society however they wish, regardless of the consequences to society. Now, in this, I think we should recognize the United States as a kind of example the rest of the world should fear. We have the idea in the United States of the canary in the coal mine, where miners used to bring canaries or other birds down into the coal mine, and as long as they were singing, everything was safe. But when the canary died or passed out, that signaled there was gas in the coal mine and they needed to get out quickly. I think the world should look at the United States and realize the United States is democracy's canary. And it is not so exceptional, the United States. What we're seeing here, I think, will spread everywhere in the world if we do not take this opportunity now to recognize the threats that these platforms are presenting to society and stand up the proper regulation to respond to them. Okay, one more word about what those regulations could be. There are many people who speak as if the only way to regulate these platforms is to control the content of the speech on these platforms. So we imagine censor boards watching the speech and deciding which speech needs to be censored and which speech should be supported. But that is not the only way to imagine intervening in these platforms in a way that protects society from the worst of these platforms. Francis Haugen, the Facebook whistleblower, has described many content-neutral ways that Facebook itself recognizes that it could intervene on its platform to slow the spread of misinformation, and in a certain sense, to slow down the process of humans interacting with their platform, to give us a chance to catch up, almost like speed limits on a highway. And we should be committed to finding these content-neutral ways to avoid the worst of these platforms. Because if we can't find a simple, scalable way to make these platforms safe, I fear these platforms are going to become unsafe everywhere in the world, and especially outside of the United States. The United States has 10% of Facebook's audience, and it has 90% of spending on corporate safety measures for the United States alone, because Facebook is fearful of the United States and its potential regulation more than anywhere else in the world. That mismatch means that the rest of the world, which has billions of people on top of that platform, is vulnerable to the effects that platform has on their democracies and on their societies. And whether it's the genocide, which has been triggered in certain parts of the world by this platform, or the general destruction of the capacity of democracy to do its work, both products are the consequence of the design of these platforms, and we need a way to step up to those platforms and demand they design them to make them safe. Thank you again so much for the opportunity to engage with you. I wish I could be there in Brazil personally. It is certainly one of my favorite places in the world to visit. Thank you again for this honor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Lessig, for this thoughtful talk that brings a lot of reflections. It was really interesting. I just want to ask you, it's 9:33 here, probably 8:33 where you are. How long do you still have for a conversation with us?
I think I have about 10 minutes before I have to race to school so I can teach contracts class.
Okay. So that's not much time. I'm going to switch to Portuguese for a minute, and I hope you can get the translation. Is that correct?
Let me see. Press interpretation. Okay, I can get that.
Okay. Então, Aline, você gostaria?
Aline, would you like to have a question for Professor Lessig, or do you want to make an intervention? What do you prefer? I guess we can make him a question, and next we move to the opening session. So, Professor, first, thank you very much for your excellent words and this opportunity to raise some of the big issues that are important for our age, that the communication, the traditional communication means television, broadcast, radio, and newspaper will be in a certain manner substituted or at least overcome by social media. As well said you in the beginning, the idea is that the internet should be a non-regulated space. And I believe that today there is no doubt on the importance of regulation. I believe this is a consensus. This is, we agree the platforms themselves, they have been changing towards this goal. So how, the question is, how do you imagine, how do you conceive this regulation? It's an autonomous coming from the state or a self-regulation, the platforms with interaction and a debate with the society, or kind on the middle of state determinations and volunteering actions from the social media. I say this from the perspective of a citizen of this in a country where the state's interference on freedom of speech is feared. So I would like to know if you have in mind a framework, a structure, a modeling of a regulation, and if you do so, if you might share with us. That's the question.
So I think what the Facebook files demonstrate is that we can't trust the companies to regulate themselves. Time and again, Facebook in particular has been called out for great mistakes that have had severe consequences. The most recent before this was the Cambridge Analytica scandal. And time and again, they've promised they would do better. And what these documents demonstrate is they have not done better. That when the company faces a choice between safety and profit, the company chooses profit over safety every time. So that means the government needs to step in to make sure that the company is internalizing the costs of its harm that it's imposing on others. And the way it can step in is not really clear. One requirement should be a formal and enforceable transparency requirement, where, you know, really technologists describe what kind of data we need to get to evaluate whether the platform is safe or not. You know, if you compare the platform to cigarettes, for example, the tobacco companies, of course, said cigarettes were safe. But the thing about cigarettes is that scientists could test whether cigarettes were safe, regardless of what the platform, regardless of what the cigarette company said. But we have no way to test whether the Facebook platform is safe, because we have no data, with no access to the data for that platform. So that's idea number one, transparency. Idea number two, an idea that Francis Haugen in testimony to the British Parliament yesterday raised. You know, our framework right now is social media companies do things, and then we have to prove that they are harmful in order to intervene to stop them. Why don't we reverse that? Why don't we require, at least for certain kinds of platforms, for example, platforms that engage kids, that the companies must demonstrate safety first? You know, just like with drugs. In the 19th century, drug manufacturers made drugs, put them out on the market, and then people would have to prove that drugs were unsafe in order to get them removed from the market. But in the beginning of the 20th century in the United States, that regime was reversed. So drug companies that wanted to introduce drugs to the market had to go to the government and demonstrate that the drugs were safe and effective. And I think that same idea should apply to algorithms. If you're going to deploy an algorithm into society, we have to have some sense that it's not going to be harmful or destructive to society, and some showing that that's true, I think, is going to be part of what the ultimate regulation of this platform will look like.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Muito obrigado.
We have like 4 or 5 more minutes. I asked Justice Fachin if he would like to make an intervention or ask something to Professor Lessig before we close this part of the panel.
Thank you, Mr. President. We have a lot of questions, a few answers, but the Professor Lawrence brought us a very relevant theme and subject to reflect and think about. I just want to express thank you, Professor Lawrence, and I hope we have in the next year opportunity to have you here in Brazil. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I look forward to that.
Obrigado. Espero muito por isso.
Well, yeah, that's that's a commitment now. We are waiting for you here next year. Find a good time for you to come, a good subject, and we'll be happy to have you talk to students and to visit our court and probably talk to the justice also.
Thank you.
Okay. Aline, unless you want to ask something, we can release Professor Lessig. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Lessig. It was a pleasure to have you here with us this morning.
Lessig.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And all the best.
Agradeço muito. Tudo de bom para o senhor.
Muito bem, meus caros amigos.
Well, my dear friends, the topic is fascinating. And, well, we got, with the need of Professor Lessig needing to leave a little bit early, we gained some minutes for us. As I had talked to Aline, I will briefly share a deep reflection on this topic. And our learning in the Superior Election Court in tackling misinformation or disinformation. I was saying at the beginning of our conversations that we had, or that we are going through that we had the Industrial Revolution and how the Industrial Revolution changed our lifestyle nowadays, how we travel, how we buy things, how we research, and how we listen to music. These days, Spotify sent me a message saying, well, the songs that you like are these. I said, okay, thank you very much. So we have this deep transformation in our time, in our life, and just as fucking we have a new vocabulary that until the day before yesterday we did not know. And these words are very important for us now in WhatsApp, Waze, Netflix, Spotify. And we have also experienced this admirable new world, which is the world of information technology, biotechnology, nanotechnology, and 3D printing and quantum computing, and self-driving cars, autonomous cars, and Internet of Things, IoT. So we are living through times, and this was emphasized by Professor Lessig, where algorithms will be becoming the most important concept of our times. The digital revolution and technological revolution, which is the third industrial revolution, the first symbolized by vapor, steam, the second characterized by the electricity, and this one now symbolized by internet, has brought very important cover and benefits and promises of longevity. But also, it brought with it lots of risks of artificial intelligence, reproducing discriminations and prejudice. One day the machines can, if they have awareness, we might have a phenomenon like singularity, and the genetic engineering, which is also advancing with concerns, since the eugenics until the temptation of creating human beings that are more beautiful, stronger, more intelligent, increasing the inequity around the world, and the risks for privacy also highlighted in Professor Lessig's presentation from the surveillance society, where the platforms have a huge amount of data, not only about our personal data, but also about our preferences, about our interests, about our fears. And we have lots of risks there. And one of them is more precisely on the topic of our conversation today, which is disinformation, internet in general, personal blogs, and the social media, as I was saying briefly a while ago, increased and enhanced exponentially the access to knowledge, the access to information, and the access itself to public space. And that had changed the logic of social communications a bit. What started to be a logic or a rationale that doesn't have more the intermediation, the total intermediation of the communication means. The main difference between the communication means that are traditional and the social media is that in the traditional communication means, we observed by Professor Lessig, a human person with a personal responsibility, accountability, that selects the news and the opinions that will be on the news. But with the social media, we do not have this filter. Any person can go there in this public space. And the criteria of amplification or reduction of the manifestation of each people will be determined by algorithms of the social media that we do not know perfectly how it happens. And nowadays, in Brazil, the researchers document that 80% of their people receive all the information via WhatsApp, and in second place, TV, with 50%. Therefore, there has been a very important, significant transformation in the understanding of the role of the social media. In the first moment, the general belief is that internet should be a free space and an open space, non-regulated space or an unregulated space, but this perception has changed in the contemporaneous world, and very importantly, and I think it's irreversible for several reasons. First, because we put a type of regulation in the economic sphere, so we can understand the market domination, so we can protect the rights of the authors, and so you can also avoid purely and simply the crimes being committed online. So you would have the need to have an economic control from the tributation or taxation point of view, and I need a regulation which is antitrust. I need a regulation of the protection for the of the rights and taxation. In second place, you need a type of regulation that would protect the privacy of the people. And the greatest part of the country, democratic countries of the country, have been editing laws of protection of privacy. We ourselves have a team in TSE court focused on the data privacy protection to comply with the legislations. We have very important and specific legislations. And this started to be a demand of regulation also from the social media on the internet, generally speaking. And in third place and last, it's important to have this control, content control, or this behavior control, or the this content control that we wanted to avoid some moments for the concerns that we have with freedom of speech, above all in a country where the past condemns the past is condemned, like in Brazil. But what we found out is that we were imposing the need to regulate, determine behaviors, and determine content. And why regulate behaviors? Because lots of times in the social media, they're using robots, false profiles, double accounts, and authorization of people's participation that would distort the importance of a news or information circulated in the media. Oh, and the behaviors called coordinated behaviors and inauthentic behaviors, they have the role to amplify news, to cause some the idea that everybody's discussing that thing, and to create artificially this fact, journalistic fact, and that would be drained, and you would then drain the relevant facts. That's a strategy lots of times being used to deviate the attention of what is relevant, flooding the internet with a false appearance that one other issue artificially is important. So therefore, the behaviors, the inauthentic behaviors must be faced, and the platforms have technological means to face these challenges, and they have to do that. And in the partnership for the elections to 2020, they were committed to doing this, and they did that in relation to the attacks to justice, electoral justice. Second of all, the control of content is, we need to block the illicit content. We need to avoid terrorism or pedophilia or drug trafficking or hate dissemination or racism, incitation to violence, or attack to the democratic institution. We need to control the content to prevent that the social media become a space of crimes being committed. And therefore, we need to tackle the disinformation or malinformation, above all when it offers a great risk for democracy or for health. As an example that we had from yesterday to today in Brazil, in relation to suppressing the presidential life after a public authority manifesting that the vaccination offers the risk of AIDS contamination. And that's an absurd, without any scientific proof, evidence, and that would incentive people not to vaccinate in a world where all the doctors and authorities are defending the importance of vaccination. So the disinformation is impacting the democracy. And therefore, we need to have some kind of control of behavior, illicit content, and disinformation that would offer risks for important values of health, of society, such as public health and also democracy, let's say. And how can we regulate this control? Oh, how can we do this control? Well, that is the matter that basically almost all democracies around the world are working on. And here we have an observation that has been confirmed by researchers and was highlighted by Professor Lawrence Lessig. That is, well, in truth, three constatations that are coming from his presentation. And I'm reflecting on. The first is that in the contemporaneous world, the great dispute is for the role. When the communication means dominated, all the circulation of the information, the spread of the information, had a dispute for the power of spreading that information and opinions. Nowadays, that's not a problem. Any person can send their opinion on air to the communication, so billions of people simultaneously can emit opinions. And that's a very important thing to say initially. The second point is a little bit sad for the human condition, which is the discovery that hate and lies and sensationalism bring much more engagement than the truth and the rational speech. That is a problem that must be tackled because that's the third problem exploited in Professor Lessig's presentation. And how hate and lie and sensationalism bring more engagement, and how the remuneration of platforms happen to the number of clicks and the engagement, and that's what determined the volume of the campaign. And the platforms would have the wrong incentives. They would have the incentive to amplify those manifestations that involve hate, lies, fake news, and sensationalism. So we need to have a regulation so these platforms could have the correct incentives to act in the interest of profit, because that's how we go in a capitalist society, but without violating the public interests and the basic values shared by the societies, democratic societies. And therefore, we have here three great topics: how to regulate if publicly, or self-regulation, or regulated regulation, or a combination of those three different possibilities of regulation, and with a need that was highlighted by Professor Lessig when he answered my question. The social media need to regulate the content. It couldn't be a way to disinformation. That would be dangerous. And we did not want to leave the state censorship to go to a private and arbitrary censorship for the moderation of content. The social media must be observing the rules of transparency. They must have rules of the due process. They must know why they were banned, why the post was deleted, and they must have the right eventually to appeal on that. And third of all, it must be isonomic treatment, fair treatment. So it cannot discriminate by religion, by gender, by sexual orientation, or political orientation, because the public space must then behave or accept all those voices that not defend violence. And about the accountability of the platforms, or responsabilization of the platforms, we have those that would be the defend objective of responsabilization. That would be the end of the platforms, and a model from Germany that they're discussing for not removing the content after a notification of the interested part. And there's a model that we chose from the CSO Internet Code, that is a notification after a legal decision, and then it is imposed the deletion or the removal with a full responsabilization. And this is Siri talking to me. And we also need to tackle this problem that Siri unauthorizedly interferes in our lives. So, dear friends and participants in this event, these are some brief reflections as Professor Leggett had time to leave. I just took the chance now to make some reflections after his presentation about disinformation and the impact on our lives, and also the impact in the democracy, which is the main concern for the Superior Electoral Court of Democracy. And Justice Fachin, we have just a few minutes left before the next panel, and I ask you if you would like to make any comments, question, remark. Right afterwards, I pass the word back to Aline Osorio so we can go to our next panel. Okay, 2 minutes only to say, President, Justice Barroso, congratulate the presidency and the whole team, Professor Aline Osorio and her staff, to organize this important event. The opening was outstanding, pertinent, with about the present challenges and what the future, which is already being present, what the future is bringing for all of us. This information elevated or increased a lot the cost of the reputational defense on the electoral justice, and it brought problems and fractures, unjustified, but they are noticeable in the trust and the confidence of the electoral process. And our main technological challenge would be to have systems and fast responses to process data and to confront and check the information, the fake news or the false information and the disinformation with the correct information and proper information. So just to reinforce your concerns, I fully agree, and I would like to say that, I fully agree with our rapporteur, and I would like to thank you for this event, congratulate everyone for this event, and I also would like to say that when we go to next year and I receive your position from your presidency, this will be a concern that I will maintain untouchable as it was defined in this presidency from you. So congratulations, President, and the whole team of TSE. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Justice Edson Fachin. And now we are ready to go to our following panel, to the next panel. Aline, do we go straight, or do I have 1 minute to talk to Professor Claire before we go on air? We are already on air, sir. Okay.
Good morning, Claire. Where are you? Good morning, Brazil. I don't know in what part of the world you are. Where are you talking from right now? I'm actually in Rhode Island in Providence because I came to Brown University and got delayed by a plane, so I'm in a hotel room, so I'm hoping that everything works. But yes, that's where I am on the east coast of the United States. Okay, we can hear you perfectly, and you are just one hour behind, so it's good morning for you also. It's morning then for us here. And I want to say it's a pleasure, it's a great pleasure and honor to have you here. I'm going to switch to Portuguese because most of our audience is Portuguese speaking. So you can switch in case you don't speak Portuguese, which I would assume you can switch to the translation mode.
Okay.
Muito bom dia.
Good morning. We have the honor here to greet, acknowledge the presence of Professor Claire Warder, that is speaking at this moment from United States in the East Coast of the U.S. Professor Claire Warder is one of the major experts on social media these days, and content generated by the users and verifications. Her research focuses on the and more visible intervention of technology, communication theory, and mass and social media. Dr. Warder is co-founder and leader of the first draft, one of the most important nonprofit organizations with focus on research and practices to tackle disinformation. First draft work
and research from the Center for Public Policy at Kennedy School in Harvard, where she is a researcher. And I didn't know about this fact, so she's a senior fellow professional. I expect to see you soon and meet you in person. And previously, Professor Wardle was research director of the Call Center for Digital Journalism of the Colombian Journalism School. And she worked with humanitarian organizations all over the world, providing capacity building, training, consultation in digital transformation. She has a PhD in communications and a master's degree in political science at the University of Pennsylvania. Thank you very much for the presence of Professor Claire Water. You have the floor.
Thank you so much, and thank you for inviting me to take part in this seminar. Some of you might know that First Draft was involved in a project called Comprova, which I'm going to talk a little bit about. So I've had the honor of coming to Brazil 5 times. It is one of my favorite countries in the world. I love it. This pandemic has stopped all the traveling, but I really wish I was with you in person. I really wish I could speak Portuguese. So I'm going to try and speak somewhat slower than normal. When I get excited, sometimes I speak very quickly. But for the translators, I'm going to try and stay calm. Even though this topic is something that we should be passionate about, and we should be angry about, and we should be upset about. So I've got some slides, because I think sometimes when we talk about these issues, it's useful to look at the visuals. So I'm going to see if this works. Everybody keep their fingers crossed. I have a thumbs up from Aline, so that's amazing. So, okay, so this is working, so let's go. So the topic of the talk is the rise of information disorder, which is a term that I coined because I felt like just talking about disinformation or misinformation didn't capture the whole problem. And I'm gonna talk about trends, lessons, and the questions that remain. So I lead First Draft, as that was explained in the introduction. We are a nonprofit that supports organizations, whether that's newsrooms, health authorities, government organizations, community-based organizations. Everybody now is tackling this problem. And so we support the trusted messengers to ensure that they have information that people can trust. And so, as I mentioned, we created and helped create Comprova around the 2018 election. And it is one of my greatest achievements in my career that Comprova still continues. Too often funders will fund a project around one election and then they will disappear. And what I want to stress in this talk is the fact that this doesn't come and go. This is now with us, will be with us, I would argue forever. We are never going to solve this problem. What we need to do is think about ways that we can mitigate the harms caused by this problem. So the fact that Comprova still continues, that it was founded in June 2018, and it's still being iterated on, there's more newsrooms that have joined, is really a case study for the rest of the world. I still talk about it all the time as a model for the kind of collaboration that we should be seeing more of. So here's one from just the other day around ivermectin. You can see at the bottom all the different logos. This kind of collaboration is astonishing. And I'm going to talk a bit later on about the Facebook Papers Consortium. You might have heard about it this week. A number of large US mainly newsrooms have had access to the whistleblower papers and they're collaborating. But the way you hear them talk is as if they're the first people to invent collaboration. But this is what we need more of. We need newsrooms to be sharing information. We should not be competing around these most important issues of our time. So I just want to stress that Comprova is really a model for this. So in this talk, I'm going to talk about what is information disorder. Then I'm going to talk about how information disorder has evolved. And then I'm going to talk about what can be done about it. The only reason I get out of bed every day is because I really believe that we can do things that will mitigate these harms. And I'm going to talk about some of that today. So what is information disorder? This was a report that I wrote in 2017, and it was for the Council of Europe. And it was an attempt to try and do a kind of a first take on this situation that we found ourselves in. And in the report, I talk very much about the role of emotion which I still don't think we talk enough about. There's this idea, if we have more facts, we'll be okay. How can we allow people to have more rational relationships to information? We are humans. There's a great study about how gorillas connect with other gorillas. They pick fleas off each other's fur. Now humans, we don't have fleas. So we connect around gossip, and we always have. And as humans, we have an emotional relationship to information. Our identities are built on the information that we believe, the worldviews that we hold. So this idea that more facts are going to save us is not enough. We have to understand the emotional and the ritual element of information if we're going to get a handle on this. And that's what I discussed in the report. And I talked about the three different types of problematic content: misinformation, disinformation, and malinformation. So disinformation being deliberately created content that people create knowing it's false or misleading and knowing that it can create harm. Now that is different from misinformation, which is when my mum sees that bit of disinformation on Facebook, she doesn't realize it's false, she doesn't mean any harm, and she forwards it because she's trying to protect her community. So that's what's happening here, is that people themselves are being weaponized. They don't realize that they're sharing this problematic content. And that's where we need to focus, because the number of true disinformation agents is relatively small. If we could block their oxygen, if we could do whatever we can to limit their impact, that's one thing. But really, if we didn't share, we wouldn't have a problem. And the third type is malinformation, because I try to make the case that some problematic content is true. It's genuine. Things like revenge porn, that is harmful content shared to cause somebody harm, but it is genuine content. The leaking of emails from a government authority, sometimes that's good. That's a whistleblower showing corruption. But sometimes the deliberate leaking of emails, as we saw with Hillary Clinton, we could argue was actually a form of information disorder. So what I tried to do in my report was to get people to understand the complexity of this space. It is not a simplistic fake news. Most content we see now is not fake, because actually, as the platforms have moved more aggressively against false content, the bad actors have had to change their tactics. And that means we see much more of this gray content, which is why I worry about a rush to regulation, because a lot of the content that we see that causes problems now, I think, how are we going to decide how we take down this gray content? So that's something that the landscape looks very different now than it did in 2016. So again, this is something I talk about, the seven types of mis and disinformation. On one end, satire, which people are like, Claire, satire, that's not information disorder. But we see bad actors labeling things as satire, knowing that fact checkers won't touch it, that the platforms won't take it down. It is a tactic that we need to know about, all the way through to fabricated content and deep fakes, which of course, lots of concern about deep fakes in the political arena. Yes, we have to be aware. And by 2024, I think we could have a situation in the US where an election might be thrown by a deep fake. In Brazil, I actually think audio is more of a concern, where WhatsApp is so much more popular. My fear is an audio message that people might say is a deep fake, other people say it's not, and it's an impersonator. We saw that during the 2018 election in Brazil. I actually think it's much easier for people to cause harm with cheap fakes. You don't need artificial intelligence to fool. But the reason that I created this spectrum was, again, to try and get people to understand there are many different ways that information disorder can play out. But here are five trends I want to talk about at the top of this talk. Firstly, conspiracy content has moved out of the fringes into the mainstream. I've been studying this for a decade. I never used to really take conspiracy content seriously until about 3 years ago, when I realized that these theories that I just could not believe would gain traction have become mainstream. And QAnon is an example of that, which from 2018 to today has completely, you know, radicalized a number of people around ideas and theories that I cannot imagine anybody would take seriously. So we have to take conspiracy content seriously. And I'll say quickly, why is it that conspiracy theories are so powerful? Because they are stories. They are powerful stories that provide simple explanations for the world. So when people's lives have been turned upside down, as they have during this pandemic, there's economic insecurity, employment insecurity, communities look very different than they used to. We've had huge technological change, and people are scared. And when we're scared as humans, we are seeking explanations that give us back a sense of control. Now, the truth is the world is messy and complex and ambiguous, but that as humans makes us feel uncomfortable. Somebody comes along and says that there is a secret cabal controlling everything, and suddenly that explains why your world is upside down. That is very compelling. So rather than us dismissing conspiracy theories, for me, we have to see what that's telling us. And it's telling us that people feel insecure. And there's something very compelling about that controlling narrative that we shouldn't dismiss. We should try harder to understand. And I don't need to tell you this, Brazil, because when I was in Brazil in 2018, seeing the use of WhatsApp, I would come back to the US and say, hey, you guys might want to understand the role of closed messaging apps. And in the US, well, oh, nobody uses WhatsApp in the US. Well, white people don't use WhatsApp in the US, but diaspora communities, immigrant communities absolutely do. And in the past, we've seen the rise of WhatsApp in the US. But you, of course, have known this for a long time. And for me, so much learning should be coming out of Brazil about the roles of encrypted messaging apps, particularly in a country where quality information is often behind a paywall, but closed messaging apps are often free to use, part of data plans. It's a critical part of kind of the two-tier information system that's now developing and is critical for us to do something about. Thirdly, visual, mimetic, and video content is getting much more prevalent and influential, but much more difficult to monitor and track. So whilst algorithms have got better at making sense of text, algorithms are really bad still at making sense of visuals. So the more that we see AI and machine learning used by the platforms to identify misinformation or harmful content, we have to recognize that we are a long, 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 long way away from being able to do this effectively around visuals. And that's happening as we see more visual content. TikTok, which is becoming much more popular in Brazil as it is globally, much more popular, very, very, very difficult to monitor. So what do we do when the kind of the content that's popular is harder to monitor? So it's still difficult to monitor Facebook and Instagram, but it's very, very difficult to monitor TikTok. And as we know, impossible really to monitor WhatsApp beyond tip lines. Four, misinformation, polarization, and hate speech continue to intersect, and people are taking advantage of existing divisions and xenophobia. I'd also say that I know this seminar is about political disinformation, but we have to understand how political disinformation, health misinformation, climate misinformation are all intersecting. We shouldn't have university departments where the political science department studies misinformation and then the public health school studies it. And then the climate, you know, we have to understand the same tactics are being used across all of these different forms. And people not wanting to wear masks or not get vaccinated, that's not just health misinformation anymore. That's about people's political identity. So the way all of this overlapped is critical to understand. And lastly, I want to talk a little bit about data deficits. So everybody talks about misinformation and conspiracies, and that's understandable. But increasingly what I'm realizing is that that's the end of the model. That many people, particularly around new events, that could be a pandemic, it could be the rollout of a vaccine, it could be mail-in voting. Whatever's new, people have questions. They're not conspiracy theorists, they're just asking questions. And so you can see here somebody saying, what is mRNA, please? You know, Pfizer rolls out mRNA, like, I don't know what it is. Somebody else saying, can it cause infertility? They are asking questions, quite rightly. Now, those of us who work in the kind of trusted messenger space, we tend to say, oh, we don't have enough data yet, so we're not gonna say anything. The problem is the disinformation agents and the conspiracy theorists swoop in and fill that vacuum, that data deficit vacuum. They fill it with conspiracy content and misinformation. So when people search on Google, that's what they find, because those of us who are trusted messengers are like, well, we're just waiting till we have enough data. So what does it mean when people have questions and we're not answering them quickly enough or effectively enough? So I keep talking to particularly public health authorities about how can we fill those data deficits earlier? Because if we're not filling them, the other side is, and they're filling it much more quickly with memes and videos and compelling content that's providing a false narrative. So how has information disorder evolved as I've been studying it? So as I said, we're seeing fewer outright falsehoods and much more misleading content. The tactics are changing. So this was the one of the most clicked on pieces of content during the 2016 election in the US, which was this idea that Pope Francis has endorsed Donald Trump. We don't see much of this anymore. We see really overt false content, but not as much because the platforms act on it much, much more quickly. So instead, we see things like this, which is, you know, this is the AP talking about vaccine rollout hit snags as health workers balk at shots. Now, this is a genuine headline. It is a good piece of journalism. But in a world where people don't read the article, they just read the headline, this AP article then gets used by conspiracy communities online to push the idea that the vaccine can't be isn't considered safe. So what we need to understand is the interplay between professional news outlets and how they're being weaponized by conspiracy theorists who are trying to push a particular narrative. And that for me is really critical. We can't talk about internet trolls in the basement and news organizations. There's an intersection here where bad actors are using the credibility of professional news sources in ways that is troubling. But again, is this content that Facebook should take down? Well, it's problematic. That's what I'm talking about. The gray area is what we see much more of. Or things like vaccine injury stories. If people are talking about their first person experience of a vaccine, do we want to shut that down on Facebook? Well, the thing is, there are a number of people who are quite obviously just sharing their own experiences. The problem is there's also bad actors who are doing this under the cover of, I'm just sharing my story, but they're doing it to sow doubt. So these first person stories of, I went to vote, I don't think my ballot box is safe. Are we gonna take down that kind of content? Or I'm just asking, you know, I've been voting for 60 years. I think it's safe, but I'm just not sure. Can somebody help me understand? Now, we don't wanna shut down that kind of content, but when you see like more and more and more of people like, I'm just asking questions. Some people are, but it's also becoming a tactic of bad actors who are trying to weaponize the loopholes in the Facebook and Instagram and YouTube policies. So the more the policies get updated, that's a good thing. But every time the platforms are clear and transparent about their policies, bad actors find loopholes so that they can find their way through those loopholes. So that, I'm not trying to be negative. I'm just saying when you watch these spaces all the time, you see this cat and mouse game between the platforms and the bad actors. And this is a great piece by Renée DeResta in The Atlantic, but she talks about the anti-influencers who are merely asking questions. So as I just said, this like, I don't know, I'm just asking. That in itself is now a tactic, and it's happening in the anti-vaccine space, but it's happening in the democratic erosion space. It is a tactic around that kind of content you can't take down if you're a platform because it's speech, but it's a weaponization of freedom of expression. This second point that I think is critical to understand, and it's so much more set by, which is the misinformation ecosystem is participatory. And when I say that, what I mean is the ecosystem that we all live in and linear. You have a trusted messenger at the top, you have the expert, and then you have the audience at the bottom passively accepting that model. On the other side, it is very participatory, which is tell us what you're seeing, be part of this. We hear you, share your experiences. And people are hearing the same disinformation from their friend around at the local bar. They hear it from a talk radio host. They hear it from their president. They hear it from their son. They hear it on the golf course. They hear it. It's dynamic. It's dynamic and it's participatory, and people feel like they're part of something. So if you spend time in disinformation spaces, people feel like they have agency. They feel like they can play a role. And that's what happened with the Stop the Steal. So Stop the Steal that emerged after the 2020 election in the US. This was a participatory campaign. It was like a movement. It was saying, tell us when you voted, what did you see? Use this hashtag. That this helps stop it, you can help stop the steal, was this perfect case study of an effective movement. Now, when people talk to me about mis and disinformation, I say, the terms don't really make sense now, because those people in the Stop the Steal groups, they believed that they were the ones who were saving democracy. When they went to the Capitol and they stood in the rotunda, they were the ones who had to on their side, the ones that saving the Constitution. So are they missing? Is that misinformation? Well, I think they knew it was harmful, except they believed that it wasn't harmful. They believed that they had right on their side. So I think about this all the time, which is our side needs to take those lessons. How do we make our information ecosystem more participatory? How do we make people feel that they're really being heard? How do we make people feel that they can play a role in cleaning up the information ecosystem? Because if we keep saying, well, we just need the right trusted messengers, we just need the right footballer, we just need the right poster on the side of a bus, we're missing the point, because we're still using the model of information and communication from 1996. And the networked model has changed completely, but I would argue we are still relying on a model from 1996, and the disinformation ecosystem understands the truly networked nature of the internet. And so, as I said, I wrote this for the Boston Globe just after the Capitol attack. And for me, people there were in an alternative reality. This isn't just, oh, you know, they've seen a few too many things on Facebook. Their whole sense of the situation was completely warped. For them, they were in a parallel reality. So what does that mean when we say, oh, we just need more fact checkers? We do. I love fact checkers. They do an amazing job. But we are working on something that is much, much, much more serious than it was in 2016. So how do we respond when we have this networked participatory ecosystem that people in that ecosystem come nowhere near the one that I live in? What does that mean to really think about mitigating these issues over the next 30 years? And I know that you know this too, but politicians are an increasing source of misinformation, which causes challenges for the media and the platforms. And this in the US became a real problem in 2018, I would argue potentially in other countries. But I wrote this piece of research about the ways in which cable television amplified Trump's tweets about election integrity. And what we found was that the media did a horrible job of basically just giving a platform to Trump's false tweets about the election being stolen, even in May, June, July, August. It was only in September that Twitter started labeling Trump's tweets. Throughout last summer, 2020, Donald Trump was tweeting all of these tweets, basically saying you won't be able to trust the election, it's going to be stolen, mail-in ballots aren't safe. And the media, as you can see, they just put them up on screen. No labels, no fact checks, they just put them up on screen. And as you might be able to see from these minutes, it was pretty significant how much airtime these false tweets got from television. So what does it mean to think about reporting on false information from politicians? I'm not saying we don't cover it, but is there a new visual language? Do we have to have labels on television? How do we do real-time fact-checking of speeches? So yes, there are real problems with internet trolls on Facebook, but we also have a problem with politicians and the mainstream media that have much, much, much bigger audiences. And that is part of our ecosystem of information disorder. And as we saw with the Facebook Oversight Board, you know, they've made their cases against Bolsonaro and Trump. You know, they are struggling with this. This is not easy, this question of what do you do around speech from those people who have a platform now via these social media platforms. But what's the responsibility here? And this is not an easy question. I do not wish I was Mark Zuckerberg, but they need to think about this. And we've seen this in the US. Since Trump has been deplatformed, there is significant less misinformation on all of the platforms. That's just what the research tells us. So deplatforming, we're starting to see, does make a difference. but it doesn't make it disappear. You know, we have more people who were deplatformed from places like Parler going to Telegram or going to BitChute or going to Rumble, these alternative platforms that have emerged to take content that has been deplatformed off the major social networks. So finally, what can be done about it? So firstly, training more trusted messengers in how to talk about and report on misinformation. And this starts, I would argue, at the community level. We need to do much more with communities to recognize who's trusted in different communities. Is it a faith leader? Is it the person who runs the local hair salon? The idea of a trusted messenger looks very different in 2021. So going back to that participatory model, how can we create a network of people in communities who can talk to one another and build resilience within their communities against disinformation? It can't just be top down. But for those of us who are in a position of being more traditional trusted messengers, things like this, studies suggest tweets mocking 5G conspiracy theory about COVID-19 may have inadvertently popularized it. There's a lot that we see from professional media, from health authorities, from commentators online that are actually causing more harm. We should not be making fun of those who believe in conspiracy theories. We should have empathy. We should be listening more to communities and why they're scared and why these rumors are taking hold. We don't know. We need to be anthropologists much more than communication specialists right now. Things like these kind of headlines, is 5G going to kill us all? You know, in an environment where clicks lead to traffic, leads to money, you know, there is an incentive for headline writers to repeat the rumor in the headline. Well, we know as researchers that by doing that, you actually give oxygen to the rumor and people are more likely to remember the rumor. So here's an example from Medical News Today. The text that's in bold and the text that is bigger, that's the myths. The facts are in a smaller font and are more complex. The way our brains operate, if I asked you in a week's time, you're more likely to remember what you saw in the bold font. So the ways that we think about headlines, the ways we think about how we talk about misinformation, we have to be very careful about leading with the truth, emphasizing the truth, wherever possible, that has to be the hook, and then give a warning. Well, there are rumors circulating that are false. You may have seen some of these rumors. They're suggesting that, you know, younger people are not at risk of COVID, but that is false. And you end with the truth again. So teaching people about the truth sandwich, as it's known, those kind of trainings are really important because we're inadvertently causing more harm by the way we're doing the kind of, you know, the kind of reporting on misinformation that happens. So here's some kind of just things that we should be doing more of, which is writing headlines to inform rather than shock or provoke, where possible, lead with the truth rather than just simply repeating the details of the falsehood. Thinking about images in a very visual world, what images are we doing? Are we using, you know, the beginning of the pandemic, there was some really, really problematic choice of images around Asian people wearing masks, which did a terrible job of stigmatizing Asian people in connection to the pandemic. What images are we using? Because often that's the only thing people see, the headline and the image. Filling information voids, as I said, proactively addressing questions before they can cause these vacuums that then get filled by conspiracy theorists. We have real problems in terms of the science that's emerging around the pandemic. We, and I say we as researchers, have done a terrible job of explaining to people that during the pandemic, guidelines will evolve. Things will change as we get more information. And I often think about wildfires. If there's a huge wildfire, the police chief will come out and say, right now the fire is here, but keep following me for updates because the fire might move here, here, here. But I promise you, I will give you the most up-to-date information to keep you safe. Now, how can we use that kind of language around the pandemic or things that are changing rapidly? We need to explain science and the way that knowledge evolves and grows, and that that is a positive thing. We know a lot more. It's Breast Cancer Awareness Week month. We know much, much more about breast cancer now than we did 50 years ago. It is a good thing that knowledge evolves. But I think we need to do a better job of explaining that. And that's fundamental to this problem with misinformation. We just need to use a broader range of credible sources. Again, thinking about who's trusted by different groups. You know, in the US, Dr. Fauci, our main, you know, America's doctor, is incredibly trusted by half the population, but is absolutely hated and despised by the other half. So who's the right messenger in different contexts? And finally, equip journalists, editors, and others to recognize, correct, and avoid amplifying misinformation. So the example there with Trump's tweets, how can reporters be aware of the ways in which their platforms are being weaponized and used by those who want to take advantage of their large audiences? Find more ways to collaborate. This will not surprise you that this is something I'm so passionate about, but this is actually from an election official during the Arizona audit. And she retweets here somebody who was using a hashtag AZ audit pool, because all of these journalists were working 24/7 to basically keep track of the audit, and they were collaborating around that. And she's like, this is amazing to see this collaboration of media outlets. So what we're seeing in Brazil with Comprova, we need to see much more of, particularly around elections, as trust is being eroded in the democratic process. How can we have more eyes from a variety of sources? So somebody who says, well, I don't trust the New York Times, the Washington Post, the AP or Reuters, I only trust Fox News. What, how can we try and have these collaborations that bring in a range of different outlets? And as discussed, we have these Facebook papers, which is an amazing example of a huge treasure trove of documents. And we're now having this constant drip, 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 drip of reporting around Facebook. Who knows? Yesterday, I think they announced another $9 billion in profits or something extraordinary. I mean, it's hard to understand how there can be such levels of reporting on Facebook yesterday, yet such a profit, but that's the world that we live in. But I do think the model of collaboration is going to put extra pressure when we need it on these platforms. And lastly, we need to find ways to inoculate audiences. So inoculation theory is this idea that if you teach people the tactics and techniques of those who are trying to manipulate you, it's the most effective way of teaching people how to build resilience against misinformation. So great work by people like John Cook or Sander van der Linden that have been doing these experiments to try and understand what works and what doesn't. And what they find, and I think this quote's really important, I found that explaining the misinformation technique completely neutralized the misinformation's influence without even mentioning the misinformation specifically. So you're not debunking, you're not even pre-bunking, which is when you say you are likely to see images of a ballot box in the wrong place. This happens every election. This is the kind of images you might see. If you see it, be very aware, because it's a known example of misinformation that circulates around elections. Now, if you push that out a week before the election, that's known as pre-bunking. Inoculation is, you don't talk about the specifics of the rumor, but you say, here are some of the reasons that people create disinformation, and here are some of the tactics they use: cherry picking statistics, or using somebody who looks like an expert, or logical fallacies, or, you know, you talk about the tactics and the techniques, and that makes people much more aware when they see it in the wild. And this last line is so important to me: whether you're conservative or liberal, no one wants to be deceived by misleading techniques. So when you say to somebody, hey, you know, you just shared that on WhatsApp, can I just, you know, here's a fact check because you were wrong. Nobody wants to be told they're wrong, and they have a worldview. So the focus on debunking after somebody has seen the information is actually pretty hard to move the needle. But if we do more to teach people the tactics and techniques of manipulation, they are much more likely when they see it not to be like, oh, well, that's actually about Bolsonaro, and that in the way that I think about it, nobody gets that personally involved with the content because it's about the tactics. So even saying to people, you know, here are some of the motivations for why people do this. Some people do it to make money. They want to trick people to get you to buy something, or they want to trick you to click on an ad because they make money, or they send you to their website because they're selling supplements. Like explaining the financial motivations, or saying, well, some people do this for political gain. These are some of the tactics that people use, whether you're from the left or the right, the same tactics get used. Or saying sometimes people do it for social or psychological reasons, like giving people a way of going, oh, okay. Because many people can't imagine, my mum, for example, why would anything this expensive have information on it that's false? She's grown up in an era of trusted gatekeepers. It doesn't make sense that people would lie. So trying to like explain to my mum why all of these factors exist is a really effective way of like building resilience. It's inoculation, like vaccines inoculate us. It's information inoculation. And so in the lead up to the US election, first draft, we created a 2-week text message course. So you would sign up and you'd say, okay, at 10 a.m., I want to get a lesson. And at 10 a.m. every day, they would receive a different lesson. And it was built around this idea of inoculation. We're currently doing an evaluation of that SMS course to see whether it worked. But we need to think about these scalable opportunities for getting more people to understand the mechanism of information disorder, rather than continuously playing whack-a-mole with particular rumors. And we do have some really, really good evidence, which is not always the case in this information disorder space. The field is still relatively young, so we don't actually have the kind of evidence base that we need before we do things like regulate. But here's a game called Go Viral. It's 5 minutes. It was designed to teach people and inoculate against COVID-19 misinformation. And then they did a randomly controlled trial, which was then written up in this journal, as you can see, which shows that people that played that game were more effective at spotting misinformation in the wild afterwards. So to me, this is some of the most exciting potential interventions in this space. And it's media literacy, but it's rather than saying, well, go and Google that headline, it's trying to build up resilience in people. So when they see it in the wild, they're more likely to spot it. And so I'm just going to end with just some final thoughts, which is there is a great documentary that the New York Times made in 2018 called Operation Infection. And in that documentary, they interview an ex-KGB chief, and they also have some footage from some spies from the 1980s talking about what they were trying to achieve in their information warfare against the United States. And somebody talks about the drip, drip, drip on a rock, and that any individual drip doesn't really cause any harm, but the continuous drip of water on the rock makes it splinter. And these spies were saying, that's what we were trying to do in the US, which was to break the US apart by this continual drip of information. And that's what I think about all the time when we think about content on Facebook or Instagram or YouTube. We sit around and we say, oh, should that video be taken down? Should that tweet be labeled? Should that Facebook post be deranked? And we obsess about each individual drip and we say, oh, I don't think that really passes the threshold. I think that's fine. But what we're missing is this longitudinal understanding of the ways in which those drips are splitting our societies apart. But we don't see it because each drip doesn't seem that harmful. So I would say that we need to think about this problem completely differently rather than focusing on the drips, because we have no idea about the long-term harm of each individual post, none of which seems that problematic. And so to me, it's completely changed the way I think about this problem. And it also has changed the way I think about this as a researcher, which is how do we think about narratives as opposed to individual posts? How do we think about how this works over time in a way that we just don't have the research around? And here's a quote from something that was published on Sunday by CNN as part of the Facebook papers. And they said, almost all of the fastest, this is from the Facebook, the whistleblower papers, almost all of the fastest growing Facebook groups were Stop the Steal during their peak growth, the analysis says. Because we were looking at each entity individually rather than as a cohesive movement, we were only able to take down individual groups and pages once they exceeded a violation threshold. We were not able to act on simple objects like posts and comments because they individually tended not to violate, even if they were surrounded by hate, violence, and misinformation. So I read this on Sunday and I was like, yep, that's the drip, drip, drip. They're focusing on that, and only when something hits a threshold did they take it down. But by that stage, it was a bit like a tap running for the weekend when you go away and you don't realize the tap is still running. So what does it mean for us to think much more cohesively about the problem? So finally, I'll say this, because I know this is part of what you're thinking about at this moment. And I think about this all the time, which is, what can we do from a regulatory perspective to think about reducing these harms? But I keep thinking about how can we just have more oversight first and foremost? Because we need more oversight based on longitudinal research to really understand what is happening in our information ecosystem. And any regulation has to be based on a strong empirical foundation. So for me, the number one piece of this is if we hadn't had the whistleblower providing those papers, we didn't have that oversight. Those papers should have been available to independent third-party auditing mechanisms from the Brazilian government or the US government. It is insane to me that we're relying on whistleblowers. Well, there has to be the power from governments to demand the kind of oversight that we're only seeing from this whistleblower. Because my fear is if we pass regulation that is not based on an empirical foundation, we could cause the kind of unintended consequences that we've seen the platforms do by moving too quickly into countries like India, and I would argue Brazil, without understanding the cultural impacts of their actions. And so I'm not saying that we don't need more control on these platforms. My deep, deep, deep worry is that we could take steps that then lead to unintended consequences that are going to seriously harm freedom of expression over the long term. But as a researcher, I want more oversight. I want more auditing. I want more third-party independent researchers in those platforms so that we can really understand what's going on. Because unfortunately, we know there's harm, but I can't give you a measure. If somebody said, Claire, how much misinformation is out there and how much harm is it doing? I can't answer that question. And I think about this all day long. I can't give you an empirical answer. And that's the problem we have. So for me, the first step is we need very quickly much, much, much more oversight on these platforms, an empirical foundation, and then regulation that's based on an empirical foundation. So that's everything I have to say. I'm sure I could keep talking. But I want to say thank you for listening. And if there's time for questions, I can take them. But otherwise, here's my, you can contact me at info@firstdraftnews.com and I'd be happy to answer any additional questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Claire, for this. It's wonderful presentation with a lot of information from your research. That's something very important. It's not just your opinion, but your opinion is based on data and thoughtful research. And you raised so many questions that and we are all very scared at this point and trying to find the proper balance between freedom of expression and the content control of social media. And of course, countries have different backgrounds, different experiences. And of course, you would be aware of how much we fear state interference with the freedom of expression. But on the other hand, of course, we don't want social media to become an instrument for crime or for misinformation and all different unethical behaviors. I'm going to switch back to Portuguese, if I may, and probably pose you a question or a reflection, okay? If you could please switch to your translation mode.
Once more, I'd like to thank from the bottom of my heart for this so rich explanation and presentation that helped us to understand better the context, and not only a presentation based on opinions and on reflections, but actually based on empirical data and research, what, of course, makes all the difference. I'd like to hear from you a little bit on, for us here in Brazil, we are afraid of state regulation. And thus we are trying to think, and there are some projects and bills being discussed in the National Congress, a mechanism that combines state's regulation and self-regulation of what some have been called self-regulated regulation, that it's to establish a model or a framework, but the social media themselves, they are supposed to adopt that measures. So I'd like to hear from you in two points. What is the relevance in what's the relevance, do you think, the working with this Facebook oversight board? What is the importance of this board to self-regulation alternatives such as this? And what do you imagine of having an independent agency, third-party agency, monitoring the social media, but also independent from the government, with government representatives, civil society representatives, users, representatives, and from the companies as well? So what do you think about these two possibilities? A self-control with a organism similar to the judiciary, as is the Facebook Oversight Board, and an independent agency with a mandatory composition from the government to perform this overseeing, this monitoring. This is the question that I'd like to listen to your reflections, please.
So in terms of self-regulation, I mean, for example, I was part of the EU high-level group in 2018, and we helped develop a kind of a code of practice on disinformation for the platforms. But my frustration about that process is that it allows the platforms to write these transparency reports that they submit every quarter, and it's full of amazing numbers of everything they've done. But we have a phrase at home, which is marking your own homework. They shouldn't be deciding whether or not they've taken down 94% of hate speech. And in fact, some of the reporting this week suggests that Mark Zuckerberg, when giving testimony to Congress, was saying, we take down 94% of hate speech. And internal documents were showing that they're taking down around 5%. I mean, there has to be independent auditing. And so the Facebook Oversight Board has been criticized by people saying, well, it was set up by Facebook, it's founded by Facebook, it's funded by Facebook. But I would say we should have moved quicker. You know, 4 years ago, those of us who care about these things should have created an independent body with historians and ethicists and social psychologists and civil society representatives and human rights activists. I wish we had created something independent. I mean, I'm glad that the Facebook Oversight Board exists, because I think it's showing an interesting model for what oversight could look like. But even in the big ruling around whether or not leaders could post, whether Trump and Bolsonaro could post, even the Oversight Board had to say, we didn't get all of the data that we asked for, because fundamentally Facebook didn't have to hand over everything. So to me, we have to have an independent entity, but with a jurisdiction and power that would come from a government to say, you will be fined if you don't hand over those documents. So to me, it has to be independent. It should not sit in government, but it needs teeth, because these platforms, they're much more powerful than the UN. We have nothing of any scale that's anywhere near these platforms. They've become our overlords, and it's happened very quickly. And at first we were so excited about technology that we kind of sleptwalked into a situation where Jeff Bezos, Mark Zuckerberg, Elon Musk, they're these incredible, powerful gods, and we have no way of really pulling back the power. So to me, we need independent oversight based on a range of expertise, researchers, practitioners. There needs to be independence, but it needs teeth. And I would argue that it needs to come from a government that could find them, because we've tried self-regulation for 3 to 4 years, and the platforms just haven't, I don't think, really come on board in a way that we can trust the kind of transparency reports they share. So to me, it's kind of a meaningless exercise. And so we tried, it's failed. I now think that we need something with more teeth. But as I said, it should be about oversight right now rather than regulation, that I think if we did that, we could end up leading to unintended consequences.
Obrigado. Eu vou fazer pequeno complemento.
Thank you very much. I just want to add something to my question, and I want to hear from you. One of the negative consequences of social media today is what we call in Brazil is the tribalization, or the creation of clusters of people that talk only to themselves and for their own groups and communities. They create a unique truth, and they radicalize their speech. So the social media didn't create a public space for debate. They created clusters of people that talk to themselves. Do you see any solution for this problem specific? I mean, any mechanism of intervention where we could have more pluralism in the network from the outside to inside, please?
Yeah, it's such a great question, and it's what we see in the US as well. And again, technology sits on top of human nature. And what you describe about humans congregating with other people who are like them, that's human nature. And so technology is amplifying what has already existed, but now it's not just in your village or, you know, in your small community. You can connect with somebody who thinks the same as you, but lives 5,000 miles away via WhatsApp. But the reason that I still have some hope is going back to what connects humans. And what connects humans, I always think, is three things. Often it's sports, particularly in Brazil, family, and faith. There are things that still bring people together. And I actually think people on this call, we know that disinformation is a real problem. But there are many people who still think it's just frivolous. Oh, it's just on Instagram, it's just on WhatsApp. You know, how harmful can it be? I do think that we all now need to say, these platforms, these social networks, have created a situation where our society is being ripped apart. You know, it's happening in the US, it's happening in the UK where I'm from, it's happening in Brazil. This is not just a frivolous, harmless thing. This is, again, pulling at the fabric. I go back to, you know, what those Russian spies were saying in the 1980s. They were trying to basically drip, drip, drips of water so society would splinter. So I think having conversations as a society, as these different communities, to say, you know what, you know, we don't talk to Uncle Paolo anymore. You know, he's in those WhatsApp groups, we've completely lost him. Like, we all kind of talk about, oh, we've lost that person down the rabbit hole. How do we say this isn't a joke? Like, how do we say that the clustering, the absence of a public square, is actually fundamental to democracy? And that if we don't take this seriously, that, you know, if I was a betting woman, I'm very worried about 2024 in the US, and it might lead to a civil war. When you have 30% of the country that do not believe in the democratic process, we'll have the midterms in 2022, which I think will be a disaster. There's a real threat for 2024. We're not playing here. So I think, to answer your question, we need to have a public information campaign about the harm that misinformation is doing. And it's not just, oh, you know, tolerate your uncle when he shares conspiracy theories. It's, if we're not careful, we are sleepwalking into a situation where democracies are going to implode. And it's that serious. And so I do think trying to make people remember that they connect with others around sport, around family, around faith, around pets. People who love dogs really love dogs. I mean, how do we find those spaces that it doesn't really matter what your political feelings are? You are connected around that, the fabric of being a human on this planet. And I'm not saying this is easy, but what I am saying is we can't just keep being like, let's just keep talking about disinformation. I mean, to me, this is the challenge. I mean, it's the crisis of our time, and it's going to impact climate. It's already impacting health because of vaccines, and it's impacting democracy. It is the number one biggest crisis that we face. But because it's on Instagram and WhatsApp, people don't take it seriously. But to me, it's like the meteor, you know, hurtling towards the planet. What are we going to do about it?
Obrigado. Nós ainda temos 5 minutos.
Thank you. We still have 5 minutes. Aline would like to make a question for you. Please, Aline.
Firstly, I would like to thank you for your brilliant presentation. And I will also switch to Portuguese to pose this question for you. Você falou muito sobre a questão...
You talked about the information vacuum, the data voices. We would like to ask you, what are the strategies to handle with the information vacuum voices? And what are the role of electoral bodies to deal with this problem?
So it's a great question. And it's partly we don't have good technology to measure what those information voids are. So, you know, I run a team of people, they spend all day using different tools to find the misinformation. We have those kind of tools. We don't have effective tools to say, what are people confused about today? I mean, we have Google Trends, which is the nearest that allows you to see what people are searching for, but it's not perfect by any stretch. And so I would say we need a kind of a dashboard that helps us say, what is it that people are confused about? And how can we have rapid response teams ensuring that we're filling those voids successfully? And there was an election in California last month. There was a recall election in California. And the election teams there did a great job of getting out ahead of the rumors. They were pre-bunking. They were telling people, you might see this. They were looking to see what people were confused about. And it was this great case study of, if you train up election officials and they're ready to go and they take this seriously, then I do think that you can see real improvements. But I would argue, you know, we have a lot. We've trained a lot of journalists at First Draft. Now I realize that we should be training election officials as well as health authority officials. Almost anybody that talks to the public needs to be trained in how to effectively manage misinformation. Because yes, we can be doing debunking, but we should be thinking, I always think about like the information supply chain. And at the moment we keep focusing at the end of that supply chain, and we should be thinking much more earlier in that supply chain about what is it that people need? Because the conspiracy theorists are much better than we are at looking at the beginning of the supply chain.
Muito bem. I'm not sure how this, someone just told me that the translation to Portuguese is very good. So I'm happy to hear that. And you know, that's a hard job, Claire, to simultaneous translation can be very tricky. And
yes. Thank you very much to the interpreter.
That we have good people, and I want to congratulate them for this good job. So Claire, thank you very much. We do appreciate the time and your insights and, you know, your thoughtful talk to all of us. And we hope that after the pandemic is over, that you can come personally to Brasília, and we'll be happy to welcome here at the Electoral Court or at the Supreme Court, and have you talk to our students here and to our judges. This is a fascinating subject. It's going to be around for some time. I don't think we're going to get rid of disinformation, misinformation, and malinformation, to use your terminology, too soon. And I think the whole world is struggling with the best ways to deal with this problem, and emphasizing, as I did before, that people are haunted by different ghosts. And one of our ghosts here in Brazil is censorship and state interference with freedom of expression. So we need to be very careful in the way we shape legislation. And there is a bill that has been approved in the Senate, and it's being discussed in the lower house. And we are all focused on that, to find the proper balance. And your presentation and your research and your contribution to this subject is very important. And I would do want to thank you for joining us this morning. And we wish you all the best. Okay.
My pleasure. Thank you so much. Thank you. Have a wonderful rest of the event.
You too. And you enjoy your stay at Brown.
Okay? Thank
you. Bye. Ciao. Muito bem.
Very well. Aline, both presentations up to now, Professor Lauren Lessig and Professor Claire Wardle, are outstanding presentations. And now we're going to have our third panel, which will be moderated by yourself, and I will pass you the word, the microphone, and I will be back at noon to moderate Phil Howard's presentation. But for now, I will pass the word to you, and I wish you all a good panel. I need just to do settle an emergency from TSE, but I will be back soon. So I will leave you on a great company of Professor Aline Osorio. Thank you so much. It is with a great pleasure and great honor that I am here participating in a second international seminar on disinformation in elections. And now we are going to kick off our first panel about how to structure the campaigns of disinformation campaigns. We had two very important initial presentation about the phenomenon. And I believe the first concern that we have to talk about when we talk about tackling disinformation would be understanding how these campaigns of spreading fraudulent informations are being structured or are being disseminated, considering the operations and the architecture of the digital information environment. And that the information disorder mentioned by Professor Claire. Today, we're going to welcome the renowned high-level speakers. We have here Professor Alicia Wendles with us, journalist Patricia Campos Melo, Professor Susan Benesch, and Thiago Tavares as well. It's a great pleasure to be with all of you. And we are now going to start the contributions. I will introduce briefly our first speaker, who is Professor Alicia Wendles. I hope you all hear me well. My connection is a little bit tricky, but I hope you can hear me well. Let me check. But Professor Alicia Wendles is the co-director of Partnership for Country and its operations for international peace. She researches how people are molded and mold the space of information in constant change. With over a decade of experience in research and analysis and focus on propaganda and war information, she focuses on this learning to assist government and large technology companies to develop policies and integrate information activities to training programs. So I pass now the word to Alicia Wendles. Alicia. A palavra é sua, Alicia.
Thank you for having
muito
me.
Obrigada, muito obrigada por me receber aqui pelo convite. Eu, na verdade, vou utilizar alguns slides. Eu acho que pode ajudar um pouquinho com a tradução também, já que eu falo tão rápido.
So, as was said in the beginning, I research how people shape and are shaped by a changing information space. I'm currently the director of the Partnership for Countering Influence Operations, which is a multi-stakeholder community of 31 partners, plus a wider network of research industry, government, and donors. Our aim is to foster evidence-based policy development to counter threats within the information environment. Now, I realize that this panel is supposed to be talking about how influence operations work, so I'm going to dig back into my old research to do that and then move forward of where we are and what we've learned about the field working on this space. So, from my own research, which dates back more towards starting from the 2016 election in the US, one thing that we found was that influence operations tend to follow a cyclical model aimed at encouraging audience participation. And so it sort of follows a seven-step process. One is the use of hyper-targeted audience analysis that is facilitated through massive data collection and the use of behavioral advertising techniques. Understanding where your audience is and what makes them tick, then the propagandists can effectively go and create inflammatory content like memes, data leaks, sensational news, that type of thing. The next step is dumping that into communities that already exist. So it's not necessarily about building new communities or astroturfing, but really putting the content where people are already getting it and then it spreads. So social media has been heavily used to do that. The next step is to really understand how that ecosystem works. So manipulating algorithms to make things spread or trend as news topics with the aim of really getting news coverage. But then what makes this quite different with social media is that the other step is to mobilize followers to action. So that can include getting them to spread a message, attack opponents, sign polls, give up their accounts for sharing. And as I mentioned, the ultimate aim here is really to get media coverage. So sometimes this is just about being sensational enough and causing a scandal to be in the media. Other times it's actually working with the media or setting up alternative news outlets that can help move things through an information change. And the last step of this is to really review, adapt, and repeat. And so it's constantly going on, and these communities get set up and used over time. Now, my work since then has moved more to understanding what can we actually do about it. And so PCIO, since it launched in 2020, has undertaken a bunch of baseline reviews. So these are meta studies that look at different topics, from proposals that have been made to the policies that platforms have publicly disclosed that they are doing. You can find that on our website, which is down there, and I'll bring that up again later. So what we've learned is that defining the problem is surprisingly hard. A lot of different terms are being used to describe similar things. This is also very much an emerging space. While there's a history of propaganda and advertising literature, understanding how this has changed in a digital space is quite new, and most of the studies have really been coming out since 2016. It's also a big and eclectic field, and the 460 global initiatives that we looked at, they tend to weight range widely. More than a third are focused on fact-checking and journalism and supporting media. The other third are research. These can cross over as well. The experts largely agree on basic next steps. Most are calling for sharing of more data, media literacy, increased regulation. These are things that have been called for a while. Platforms have been making tweaks, at least that's what they're publicly saying, and those interventions tend to focus mostly on redirection and content labeling. And the regulatory approaches are also increasing. So the laws that could cover aspects of influence operations have been growing, particularly in the wake of COVID. So what are the gaps? One thing is that if we're talking of a whole society solution, most countries lack the glue that holds all of these together. So you can look at it in different layers, understanding influence operations, the researching side of it, what the journalists do, investigators, but also the people who are trying to counter it, where we know the least about the impacts of that. But then there are also multiple layers of points of intervention where we could do things, including government, which, you know, has the lever of regulation, but also funding. One big thing that stands out in terms of a lack of whole society solution is that there is no obvious field here. There's no key leading institute where I could recommend you go and study and you're going to be brought up to speed. A lot of the collaboration and convening is ad hoc, so it tends to lack an aim, and information sharing tends to be a little bit more on a promo basis. So just to give some context of how difficult it is to try to be a layer in between, we have an 8C approach to change, which is our aim to try to have multi-stakeholder engagement around transparency reporting, data sharing, rules and research collaboration. And it begins with building community and also consulting them and undertaking in-depth interviews, convening them, having some sort of aim towards recommendations that can actually be moved. What's lacking, according to the field, tends to be consistent. A big thing is a lack of operational funding. Most of the funding in the space tends to be project-based, which is reflected in the fact that we have more case studies than systemic research on this. We really need to be able to fund independent programs that can start to work through complex things like comprehensive transparency reporting. There's also a lack of geographic and demographic diversity in the field. Now, partly this is based on our inability to speak all the languages in the world, but the vast majority of initiatives that we found are concentrated in North America and Europe. And implementation around policy proposals still lags. Claire Wardle mentioned this. You know, people have been calling for transparency reporting and regulation for years, and we don't seem to be further ahead. One of the reasons is that policy proposals tend to lack the details that then governments and industry could implement. In terms of knowledge, we have key gaps in understanding how the information environment works as a system. Most research focuses on individual isolated campaigns. We don't know a whole lot about the threat or impact of influence operations, particularly on social media, and there's very little research around measurements targeting non-Western populations, and most of the research is on Twitter because their data is more readily available, and we know even less about solutions. So platforms, as we already have heard, aren't reporting on the efficacy of interventions. They may be doing those studies, but we're not getting access to that. Only 8% of the publicly disclosed interventions that social media companies made, we looked at, even mentioned efficacy without sharing whether it had an impact or not. So we don't know much about the impact of deplatforming or content moderation, even less on algorithms. So then we wanted to know, why do we know so little? So we rolled back to understand why we don't have answers here. And we realized that evidence-based policy is hindered due to a lack of transparency reporting by companies to inform what data is even available for research. Researchers go in, ask for data, the companies say, what do you want? And then the data, the researchers say, and the companies say, well, we can't give you that. And it's just a chicken and an egg over and over again. But even if we knew what was there, we don't have data sharing rules to facilitate research to understand influence operations. So some data may be too sensitive to simply share publicly. So there probably needs to be some framework there to ensure that happens. And even if we got that far, we don't have an institutional framework for facilitating data access and research collaboration between industry researchers and policymakers, in particular, that keeps the independence of the researchers. What occurs now is ad hoc, and researchers who engage with industry are at risk of losing their own credibility just for engaging. And this is not sustainable. So what could governments do in particular? First, I would say be strategic. One thing that doesn't seem to be answered by most democracies quite yet is, why are we intervening in the information environment? What are the values driving us, and what do we hope to see at the end of this? Then looking at all of the available levers that are open to being, to making an intervention. And then kind of understanding, like, how are we going to look at success? How will that be measured at the end? But also be strategic in funding. Governments have a lot of power there. Invest in multi-stakeholder networks, mix investigations, media literacy, solutions testing, and awareness raising. They have to work together. And that can be mandated through collaboration as a requirement for funding. Remember, whole of society needs glue. Invest in initiatives that can bring it all together, because that does take effort. Look beyond projects to operational support. Give these initiatives a couple years of running room to actually be able to tackle strategic things. And where you can't fund, connect with philanthropies. There are other great bodies supporting work here. And above all else, to identify priorities and measure success, we really need to regulate transparency reporting by tech companies. This needs to be comprehensive and detailed, ideally broadly harmonized globally, so more researchers in more countries benefit and have access, and increase the likelihood that companies cannot ignore this and they can meet those requirements. But we also need to introduce data sharing rules to ensure safe exchange of data between industry and researchers. Ultimately, we do need a framework that brings researchers together with industry and policymakers, so we develop solutions in an independent framework. One option is to look at the European Center for Nuclear Research, CERN, and develop one for the information environment to facilitate data access and collaboration between industry, researchers, policymakers. And that is it. The studies I mentioned are all available at the website there, ceip.org/PCIO. Thanks.
Hey, thanks, Alicia, for your great presentation. Now we turn to Patrícia Campos Melo. A Patrícia Campos Melo, vou voltar para o português, é repórter...
I'll switch back to Portuguese. She's a special reporter from Folha de São Paulo newspaper. She was a winner on several awards, including from Columbia University.
Ela é formada em jornalismo.
She's graduated by journalism in USP and graduated in business economic reporting by the University of New York. And she's the author of the book Hate Machine, about the use of social media to manipulate elections and electors in Brazil, voters in Brazil, India, and USA. Since 2014, Patrícia has been reporting about the disinformation campaigns on the social medias to manipulate the elections and the public opinion in India, USA, and Brazil. So Patrícia, I pass the word to you now. Thank you so much for your participation. Thank you very much, Aline. Thank you for the invitation to be here. Well, the purpose of this panel is great, to talk a little on how these disinformation campaigns are structured. And for the people that are always involved in the discussion, they always have the hope that there is a huge power in the bunker controlling the disinformation structures, sending controls and commanding control. But that's not how it goes. If that was the way, it would be much easier to fight against disinformation. Of course, that we have some key characters for this disinformation process to outline the strategies, gather money and bundle some for some operation. But the geniality and the risk of the network is that it's decentralized, and lots of these information services is outsourced. or for inauthentic accounts, or for entities without any direct connections with the those who benefit from this information. Let's talk about the Brazilian example then. It was a convention to call the hate office a structure that exists for communications in the government directly connected to President Jair Bolsonaro, composed by public workers, where they outline strategies for communication, which analyze political and the network. And among these workers, we have Arnaud, who is a special assistant of the president and near to Carlos Bolsonaro, the son of the president, and he was the creator back there in 2015 of the page Bolsonaro Opressor, a page of memes in favor of the representative Bolsonaro who criticized the opponents. And that office, the hate office so-called, is a communications office that outlines strategies, digital strategies, and makes a network analysis. So the topic that we want to see in the internet, because we want to privilege or expand the reach, some people that would be criticizing us, we want to attack to this person, and this topic is negative, so let's launch another topic that will call more the attention, like a campaign of smoke. So this hate office launched this disinformation campaign, and they also control things. Not that they're the author, but they select and share the memes being produced, lots of them voluntarily, by Bolsonaro's supporters. And this information is disseminated or spread by an ecosystem of disinformation. So it starts being disseminated by social media accounts, even by President Bolsonaro and the children, the sons of Bolsonaro, and political odds, and it's amplified by bloggers, YouTubers who support Bolsonaro, the extreme right, and they are automated and semi-automated accounts like the bots and cyborgs, as they called. And another important part is that it's amplified by millions of people, real people, that agree with what is being disseminated and said, or they believe in that, or that is aligned to their beliefs. So it's not enough for us to have that hate office or a bunker, even though that has an important role. But this ecosystem, parallel ecosystem of news, is behind the information. And July last year, the lab, a forensics lab of the council, reviewed and made a research in collaboration of the Facebook data. 80 Facebook accounts and Instagram accounts had coordinated inauthentic behaviors. And that showed a little bit of how they operate in the accounts that were registered by assistants of Bolsonaro supporters, representatives, and they are very similar to news accounts like Bolsonaro News. And they did not review, they were connected to the government, and they were spreading memes, fake news, messages, images, pictures, etc. So the Ministry of Justice, Sergio Moro, had just left the government, and he had become a persona non grata in the palace, besides being an election threat. And lots of those memes would be disinformation to Minister Justice Sergio Moro, calling him a traitor, communist, lots of attacks to the Federal Supreme Court, and the disinformation related to COVID as well. That became something very political here in Brazil. And a lot of these campaigns have a very important aspect, which are they are cross-platform, as we say. And these memes and the audios and the videos, they are circulated on YouTube, from YouTube to Instagram, to WhatsApp, to Facebook, to Twitter, Telegram, etc. And in this hate ecosystem, there are two important components for us to investigate and try to identify, which are the intermediaries and the funders. In the case of WhatsApp, we have here several marketing agencies that offer mass messaging and the sales of databases. There are services for public groups, for example, those established by public links, determine candidates. So you know that you're going to send a message for a group which is willing to believe in that type of message. And also, we have the sales of information of consumers by gender, political orientation, and etc. And that has a lower efficacy. We don't have a qualitative study on that, but I believe that if you send randomly to a person on Saturday morning a meme, probably is the call center people trying to sell you an apartment on Saturday morning.
When you send it in a group, it's more efficacy. After 2018 elections, where we have this huge number of information spread through WhatsApp, the WhatsApp platform started to suit the agencies that provide this kind of service, and the Electoral Supreme Court has a resolution from 2019 in force that prohibits the use of this technique. There are some companies that provide these services in the database selling. There are some softwares, there are cheap softwares that can be purchased on the internet where it erases the name of users and cell phone, certain groups of cell phone that post certain hashtags on Instagram. They are also intermediaries, agencies that provide services named network analysis or digital marketing. For many times, they create inauthentic profiles and automatize and semi-automatized profiles. In case of WhatsApp, the company applied friction mechanisms to reduce the information verification and the limit of members in groups and messages forward. And WhatsApp, it's a huge concern in Brazil because more than 9% of what smartphone users in Brazil use WhatsApp. And Telegram, that is present here, kind of double the number of users. Many of them have Telegram and WhatsApp, but it's hard to measure that, but almost 50% of smartphones have Telegram. And the problem of Telegram, as Aline said, is that Telegram has no authority or restriction. The groups are and channels are huge. They work as a list of transmission than an interpersonal communication, as groups with almost 200 users, channels that reach millions of members. The company has no legal representative in Brazil, has no interlocution, or does not respond to any TSA request at the electoral court awards that, and even if the prosecutor's offers, and etc. And we have a big spreading, and is a member from the FGV that is monitoring these activities in Telegram and WhatsApp. We have groups with hundreds of millions of people, groups about creating votes and stalling elections, and the COVID treatment. And it's important to find these intermediaries because for many times they offer services out of the use of the terms of use of the platform, and have platforms that offer services like ads boosting, etc. But it needs to be improved. As Alicia said, we need more transparency, but it has been improved in a sense to review in case of Facebook for whom they sell political ads, what is the public, and of course with more transparency, we'd be better to understand the campaign's objective. Another important component is the funding. Some of the biggest disinformation disseminators, they are YouTubers, influencers, or websites that seem to be a news website, but they have all the news with bias or rewrite, or they are towards ideological purpose. We can name this website as a party website. So we have one of them that is named Terra Brasil website that disseminate news with this ideological bias. And they found this website and many more tubers with their YouTube's monetization, and also sell their ads in the Google through Google Ads. And for many times they are fed with materials, video, memes, etc. by the presence of the Republic advisors. And this video has a large audience. There are videos from the president, and they are feeding the president's base audience with these videos. Some of them established operations out of Brazil where they channel the profit. We can see that in the anti-democratic acts that we had
Discover this financial engineer on websites funding, and also through donations. It's not transparent with crowdfund websites, and also from public servant donations. There are some businessmen that are aligned and found some of these of websites as the Critica Nacional website against the agents' work. And those are troll farms funded. And these expenses are third parties expenses. They have no direct benefit. So this is difficult to track. This is hard, not in Brazil, but in India, we have some entities and foundations that are not linked with those who benefit from the information, but they are there funding and disseminating this sort of campaign. Some countries, and I guess was said in the seminar, they commit the mistake to criminalize this network social works users through using this information. We have some hard legislation like Singapore, Vietnam, etc. But from my opinion as a journalist, from someone that is working this small piece of this engineering trying to monitor that, is to trace and identify who is funding these operations, who are the intermediators providing this service, and who is behind the inauthentic accounts, especially connecting the connections, identifying the connections between public money, etc. And there are the need to have fast action to oversee the political context and the creation of groups that spread electoral information. One of the criticisms that have been in the platforms in the United States since 2020, and we had that on Facebook files, that the platforms took too long. The large number of groups have stopped this year emerging, and they watered this dilemma that is huge between freedom of speech versus electoral threats and influence operation. This is, I guess, these are some of the things that we are trying to figure out how to do, and we will continue to do that. This is it. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Patricia. You touched upon an important thing, that is the fact one of the most effective strategy to tackle this information that is large scale disseminated through this coordinated network is to trace, to follow the money paths. So now we move to Professor Susan Benesch. Professor Susan is founder and director of the Dangerous Speech Project, a nonprofit research team that studies dangerous speech and ways to counteract it while protecting freedom of expression. She's also a faculty associate professor of the Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society at Harvard University.
It's a pleasure to have you here. First of all, muito obrigada. Thank you so much for inviting me to take part in this very important and illustrious event. It's my pleasure and my honor. I will offer just a few ideas to supplement the many important things that have already been said. First of all, you have heard that I founded something called the Dangerous Speech Project. This is an independent research team. We work on lots of things, but the core of our interest is a particular category of human communication that I have given the nickname Dangerous Speech. This is any kind of human communication that can lower normal human barriers against intergroup violence. After all, condoning or taking part in violence is not normal. People are not born hating other groups of people. It has to be taught. It is, in fact, taught in extraordinarily, almost weirdly similar ways. What I observed about 10 years ago is that malevolent human leaders who want to turn one group of people against another one tend to use exactly the same rhetorical techniques, of which I have listed quite a few after unfortunately studying a lot of this kind of discourse. It is so striking how similar this kind of communication is that one would think that there is some kind of horrible school, secret school somewhere, where these people go to learn all of those same lessons and then be able to communicate in these ways, which unfortunately seem to be very effective to make people believe that someone else poses a threat to them. You know, the most common term for inflammatory or offensive content is hate speech, principally in English, but also now in many other languages. I would imagine there's a translation in Portuguese. Hate speech, it's called. I'm not so fond of that term for reasons, including it's not really about hatred. The most important relevant emotion in dangerous speech and also disinformation, with which it overlaps greatly, is fear. Not hatred, but fear. What you really want to do if you are an effective, dangerous speaker or purveyor of disinformation is to persuade people that some other group of people pose a threat to them. Ideally, an existential or mortal threat. That is tremendously motivating for people. It will get them to do all kinds of things, of which, of course, voting for somebody is fairly early on the spectrum. So of course, dangerous speech is very often false. You can think about the sorts of slander, the sorts of lies that political figures tell to their own people about another group of people. It's also important to note that dangerous speech is a very useful political tool for people who are political candidates and also people who have already taken office. It is, after all, much easier and it's very effective as a politician to persuade your own supporters that their problems, for example, not having enough electricity, or the roads are not very good, or there aren't enough schools or hospitals where they live. It's very useful if you are their leader to persuade them that the reason why they have these problems is that there's this terrible other group of people, or more than one other awful group of people. That's much simpler than actually fixing the problems if you are a political leader. And unfortunately, it seems to be very effective. So we, my colleagues and I, have done quite a lot of substantive work on disinformation that is both false and inflammatory. And I'm happy to talk a bit more about that, perhaps in response to questions, since I look forward to those. There, that's often the best part. But first, let me make a few more observations about disinformation and disinformation campaigns specifically. First of all, we have observed that there is, unfortunately, a low bar for disinformation. What do I mean by that? It doesn't have to be very convincing, and it doesn't have to completely convince people in order to be effective. People can be worried effectively from the point of view of the disinformation spreader, successfully worried, that is to say, worried enough to make them act, for example, to vote for someone. They can be sufficiently worried, not necessarily because they believe that the disinformation is true, but because they believe that it might be true. In other words, it's enough to introduce a significant doubt in the minds of a lot of people in order to change their behavior. Second reason why there's this low bar, why you don't need really to convince people strongly or robustly of disinformation, is that often they decide that the solution to possible disinformation, possibly true disinformation, is to put their weight behind a leader who tells them, "I will protect you, don't worry." So if people can convince themselves that this leader, and we are very familiar with the phenomenon in my own country, Donald Trump is a great example, unfortunately. If they convince themselves that this leader will protect them from whatever it is, whatever terrible threats, frightening realities are out there, then they don't worry so much about the details of what is true and what is false, or how true or how false, because after all, as we all know from long studies of propaganda and now disinformation, the line between true and false is sometimes not absolutely rigid. Often disinformation sellers, disinformation spreaders, will take something that has a grain of truth and then distort it significantly so that there's some bit of truth in it together with falsehood. It can be exhausting for people to try to sort out, to try to distinguish real truth from real falsehood and the stuff that is somewhere in the middle. So often a political solution for people is to choose a candidate or a leader who promises them that, usually he, but he or she will take over the task of distinguishing truth from falsehood and make the right decisions, and most importantly, protect them. So this is why we have this low bar for disinformation, which is a very important feature of understanding why and how campaigns can be successful. Another such feature is the quite significant transnational connections among purveyors of disinformation. I mentioned that they often use exactly the same rhetorical techniques. They also often feed off one another. When people in one country see that disinformation is successful in another country, it can influence them significantly. I'm ashamed to say that in the United States, clearly we saw the production and spreading of masses of disinformation that then also moved abroad and did significant damage abroad. For example, regarding COVID, this is one of the easiest examples to track, since not everybody suggests, for example, that one should use chlorine bleach as a cure for COVID. And that's just one example of egregious disinformation that that tragically spread abroad. But we also have examples of electoral disinformation that have been spread directly or have been copied abroad. Then I want to mention another really critical point in my view, which is that as Patricia said, millions of people voluntarily forward disinformation, and this is absolutely crucial. Alicia also made reference to the fact that disinformation campaigns are professional operations, but that they rely on persuading lots and lots of ordinary people to take up the task, to become, if you like, volunteer disinformation spreaders. So it's very useful to understand those people, because without them, the campaigns wouldn't be anywhere near as powerful for two reasons. One is they're enormously numerous. The only way that the authors of disinformation campaigns can reach the numbers of the people who forward disinformation is with bots. And that leads me to the second, bots, that is to say, bits of software pretending to be people. And that leads me to the second reason why the large number of people who spread disinformation are so important. And that is precisely, they are not bots. They are humans who have influence over their friends and families that neither bots nor the authors of disinformation campaigns can have. Very often when someone receives a message from their good friend, from their neighbor, from their child, grown-up child, from their auntie, it has much more influence than if the message comes from an unknown or anonymous source. So now, what's easy? I suggested it's useful to try to understand those people, and I will offer you just one very important point about them, which is this. It's easy to forget when we refer to disinformation as inauthentic behavior, as the tech companies like to do. We forget that many people forward disinformation with good intent. their behavior is not at all inauthentic from their perspective. On the contrary, it's highly authentic and it is well-intentioned. They see themselves as protecting often their friends and family. We have seen this
in
innumerable cases. Just to mention one to you, there was a horrible spate of lynchings, of torturings and killings of people in India in response to messages that circulated on WhatsApp. WhatsApp is also enormously important in India. Those messages told people that there were groups of child kidnappers circulating in their vicinity, people who wanted to kidnap children. So as you can imagine, this is a very good way of making people, as I said, fearful and making them perceive other human beings as posing a terrible threat. Millions of people forwarded these messages with only the best intent. What is more important or more virtuous than protecting children from terrible people who want to take them away? So we see this also in many different cases. Finally, I'd like to talk just a little bit about the tech companies, the companies that own social media platforms. Alicia very, very helpfully opened this topic. And it's one that I work a lot on, particularly at the moment. So I'd like to note that, first of all, as she said, the platforms have tweaked their policies to some extent. They have not, however, significantly changed their algorithms, like what Facebook calls the news feed algorithm, which is absolutely vital for disinformation campaigns, since that is the sort of software that offers people not only specific information, but pages and groups to follow. We saw the vast destructive importance of these algorithms most recently in a brilliant paper in the MIT Technology Review that reported on about 20 of the biggest right-wing Christian Facebook pages in the United States. When I say the biggest, I mean followed by the largest number of people. And among the many striking findings reported in the paper was that the vast majority of the people who are consuming the content, a lot of it disinformation from those pages, never followed the pages. They never searched for them and found them. They did not go looking for that content, in other words. Instead, it was provided to them, offered to them, pushed to them by the algorithms of the platforms. This is absolutely vitally important to understand how it is that disinformation spreads and really sinks its claws into people's minds, if I may be so vivid about it. Alicia also proposed that transparency reporting by the companies be regulated. That would be a good start, but as she also implied, it's nowhere near enough. The companies do what they call transparency reporting, which means releasing some information about some of what they do. But frankly, the reports represent a very small flea on the back of a very, very big rhinoceros. And in particular, the companies are choosing that flea. They report, for example, how many pieces of content they have taken down in response to government requests. But the government requests are only a tiny, tiny bit of the total millions of pieces of content that just Facebook takes down every day. It's maybe worthwhile here to pause and note that just one company, Facebook, is regulating human communication right now much more than any government does or than any government ever has in the course of human history. It's an astonishing amount of power, and we know almost nothing about how they are discharging that power. So in my view, we need a robust system of regular oversight, but not only of content moderation, not only of the platform's decisions to take down content and to take down entire accounts, but also, at least as important, some oversight of how they build and deploy their algorithms that are pushing content out to people. And I'm not the only one who is strongly supporting this idea. You have surely heard of the Facebook whistleblower, Frances Haugen, who testified before the US Senate just recently, and I believe before the UK Parliament also this week. When Frances was asked by a senator what she would do if she suddenly became CEO of Facebook, the first thing she said was that she would design and offer a system of robust oversight regarding what the companies are doing, without really understanding how information travels and how it shifts human behavior. I think we will only kind of nibble around at the edges of the problem of disinformation. And to end on a positive note, the companies are sitting on gigantic mountains of data, of information, our data and that of their billions of other users. They control this information exclusively. We could think about those mountains of data actually as mines, you know, like gold mines that have loads that have, you know, little rivers of invaluable human knowledge hidden inside them. Of course, data must be shared very carefully, ethically, and responsibly to protect privacy, especially, but also to make sure that this process doesn't lead to other harms. However, that data presents an opportunity to learn about human behavior, to learn about how and why people come to believe what is false, much more effectively than we have ever been able to do as human beings, because we have never been able to capture and track human communication to this extent. Thank you so much. I look forward to questions and to listening to Tiago.
Many thanks, Professor Susan. It was a brilliant presentation. I wish I could hear for much longer. But now we turn to Tiago Tavares. Tiago Tavares é o fundador e presidente da SaferNet.
Tiago is the founder and president of SaferNet, a non-profitable organization, which is a reference in security and digital security in Brazil. He's a professor in post-graduation in technology since 2005, and he's been a counselor of the steering committee for internet between 2014 and 2020. Thiago, the floor is yours. Thank you very much for being here.
Thiago, ainda não está me ouvindo.
Perdão, agora sim. Agora vai.
Sorry, I believe now you can hear me. Yes, we can. Well, can you see my screen? Just fine? Okay. Good morning. Good morning to all of you. Thank you so much, Aline, for the invitation to be here. And I like to say that for me it's a great privilege and a great responsibility as well to be speaking after my two main references in the topic, Professor Alicia Wenles and Patricia Campos Melos, besides Suzanne Benesch, whom I already had the opportunity to talk personally after some international conferences where we participated in the USA. Well, here I have my explanations just for you that might be curious about it. And my agenda today here, my structure of the presentation today is trying to focus with this rich contribution of my colleagues, my panel colleagues that were brilliantly speaking before me. And for those of you that do not know, SaferNet Brazil is a civil organization, non-profitable, without any kind of political or party or ideological involvement. And for 15 years, we worked to defend and promote the human rights on the internet. And it's a reference in citizenship and digital safety in Brazil. SaferNet is also the only institution in Brazil who is member of NHOPE and works in partnership with 46 whistleblowing channels that work with do a similar work to us in 43 countries. We operate the Brazilian channel in a formal partnership with the Public Prosecutor's Office for over 15 years and other institutions as well. We have anonymous form for whistleblowing, and you can denounce and tip any crimes like hate, discrimination. And just to give an idea for our public on the size and dimension of our challenge, on the first 12 years, almost 4 million tips and denounces, and now the involving almost 1 million in different URLs or websites hosted in more than 100 countries. And that shows us the importance of this international cooperation in this area. Looking to these figures and numbers and working on evidences, we can notice the existence of some triggers that demonstrated in these waves that generate, well, not only disinformation waves, but also hate content, and that's strongly associated to election periods. And there's a persistence and a prevalence and an increase on the number of whistleblowing and denounces and hate content on periods of election, mainly on the previous election. They were more polarized, and that reinforces the perception that internet is really a box of resonance of the society, when, as Professor Susan Benesch highlighted to us. And talking about some of the numbers, you know, the crime of hate, racism corresponds to 20% of the whistleblowing contributions. More than 2 million, 50%, are associated to hate crimes, and 69% of the victims that look for SaferNet support are women. So we do have a gender, an important gender impact there. And Professor Claire, in her presentation, mentioned that the hate speech is inserted in this context of malinformation or disinformation, that is one of the main pillars of methodological organization that we call information disorder. And for today, I would like to focus a bit more on the motivations. The debate in Brazil is strongly focused on content regulation and a little bit focused on the motivation of those actors that are engaged and that are setting up structures to disseminate hate. And I would like to talk a little bit about these motivations that could be financial, political, and could also be ideological, but they could also be a strive for power, people that are fighting for an election, so they're trying to win that election, and etc. And I would like to focus as an analysis frame those neo-Nazist groups and the white supremacist groups that are acting here in Brazil. There are currently in Brazil hundreds, literally hundreds of extreme cells in activity. And these groups, they do not accept and they cannot live with diversity. And they defend the violence and they spread hate against people due to their race, color, religion, sexual orientation, special development condition or deficiency conditions, and also their national origin and regional origin. And for example, the Northeast citizens, like myself, are against the Brazilians that live in the north region of Brazil. And but therefore, there is a fragmentation and lots of times a rivalry between these different militant groups. Lots of times there are signs that are even more clear and more evident of an attempt of coordinating and instrumentalizing these groups, and I'm here referring to the different groups. These groups, they identify themselves naturally through some symbols, their own symbology. It's very chronic and disturbing when we see public authorities in Brazil reproducing, also in some events and official documents, these icons, the iconography used by extremist groups of Hitler orientation that defend ideas that are eugenist, neo-Nazist, and that would threaten people that think different from them. And on those most severe cases, they defend the killing of those people. And these groups, they feel that they are legitimate and empowered. And they are also always remembered by those authorities, and also by the highest authority in our country. We know that violence acts have been practiced by these groups for over a decade. And these examples that I bring on this slide make evidence that violence and hate have been coming from the networks and going to the streets, Brazilian streets, for a long time. The situation is only becoming worse with time. And it's the peak when the institutions themselves, democratic institutions themselves, and their representatives and their members are direct target of these attacks, and lots of time coordinated attacks. The evidences, the official evidences, let's say, prove that some extremist groups, including the neo-Nazist orientation and Hitler orientation groups, they have facilitated access to weapons that are of exclusive and controlled use of the armed forces. They spray in churches, universities, public bathrooms, public spaces, and these paintings are very common, popular the past years. Financial revenue is obtained with the commercialization and sales of lots of products that talk about hate and that spread these symbols for the spreading of Nazism. This is a crime being typified in Article 20th of Law 7756 of 1989. And during those electoral processes, those groups become very active. And I would like to remember a famous sentence, a statement of Hannah Arendt in the classic Origins of Totalitarism, to dialogue to the brilliant speech from Alicia Wanas. And when Hannah Arendt said that the power of doctrine power is focused on the propaganda, and the propaganda, in quotes, tries to doctrine, because the force of the totalitarian propaganda resides in the totality to isolate the masses from the real world, to offer them a completely imaginary world and far from reality. And that was said over 30 years ago. And what did we see in 2018? Well, forums, neo-Nazist forums in the web, open web, but mainly on dark web, and lots of Telegram groups, neo-Nazist cells as well, are organizing themselves. They organized and they are still organizing themselves, and they are being coordinated to interfere in electoral processes in Brazil. In 2018, for example, they organized a war, a Linux war, using the Nazis doctrines from the Second World War, which consists in flash attacks, lightning attacks, and surprises the defense of the enemies. There are enemies that must be eliminated.
They do not allow its tempestive reaction. Here are some examples. Brazilian Portuguese of Nazis and Hitler propaganda pieces disseminated in Brazil. Present official documents of the Public Prosecutor's Office. Also in 2017 and in 2018, members of a neo-Nazi group first was arrested in 2012 and the second arrested in 2015 in federal police operations. They created a crypto coin named Bolso Coin with the aim to have profits with
o plano fracassou.
The anonymous donations with the campaign. The plan failed, followed with a sentence over than 40 years in prison, sentence ordered by Dr. José Gray, the federal judge of Curitiba. And he was threatened. Has a life threatened by the members of this group. The leader of this neo-Nazi group been refused and resisted to accept a plea with the authorities. Here there are some numbers that show what I said, that elections are kind of a trigger, and usually there are an explosion of the numbers of complaints related to hate in Brazil. This is data from the first and second election in 2018. I'd like us to bring to the discussion. This is the financial reason. There's a report from last month in Germany that aimed to map how neo-Nazis and extremist groups in Germany, they monetize content and sustain the movement. So there are different groups active in Germany, in different platforms, and financial platforms, credit card, fintechs, banking. So there are a whole digital ecosystem used, properly and illegally used, to fund this kind of activity. What shows a higher need to moderate the platforms and overseeing and compliance measures by the monetary authorities of the countries. Professor Susan Banish, in her brilliant presentation, she approached the speaker's role. This is her framework, and every time I hear her, I learn a lot. And she talked about the speaker's role in this process. Another professor, Kate Starvin from the University of Washington, this is a National Science Foundation researcher in the United States. Using a Professor Susan Bennett's framework, she literally designed to draw on what happened during the January 6th Capitol's attack this year, and the role of the, what she names, liquid politics, the mobilization of this public to perform violence acts that result including deaths during the Capitol's attack. Sorry to interrupt it. We are our time. We have a keynote speaker prepared to speak. So unfortunately, I'd like to ask you to move to the conclusions of your presentation so we can continue the event. Perfect. So I'm going to finish in 1 minute. Just to once say that the internet has more than 7,000 autonomous systems connected, and there is huge application diversity. It is important to understand that one of these applications, the parlor, has a pivotal participation during the Capitol's attack, And this graph helps us to understand how Power App was used by these attackers, and the outright now decide to create their own hardware. So they are creating their own hardware and software infrastructure to this kind of attack. And this is not new. We have seen this happening in the Mexican Northern with the Sinaloa cartel that create their own telecommunications structure, their own to in order to communicate between the members and also to perform attacks for journalists, and so they communicate among the gang. And here the balloon effect, I mean, if you press one side, they go through the other side. So we need to be aware about that. There is a big literature in the drugs war that can help us reference to this idea. So we believe that to trace the money is more efficient than the traceability proposed by the Bill 2630 in Brazil. And the conclusion is this: we believe that it's necessary to have incentives to evolve ethical capitalism and also sanction the predatory capitalism that is well represented by some of these emerging startups then are being used to as being used as instrument and industry to disseminate hate content, not only in Brazil, but in the US and several other countries. I finish here with this Mandela's quote that nobody is born hating another person because of its skin color, origin, or religion. To hate, people need to learn. If they can learn to hate, they can be taught to be to love. So we still have hope. Thank you very much. Thank you, Thiago Tavares. And also, thank you for this positive message. So I'd like to thank all the speakers and this panel. This first panel is finished, and I give the floor now to Justice Barroso for our keynote speaker. Thank you very much.
Good
afternoon, everyone. I'm apologize for being for a few times, but I'm back now. But I can't miss this opportunity to acknowledge great people in this panel: Professor Alice Wendlas, journalist and writer Patricia Campos Melo, and Professor Susan Bennett and Thiago Tavares that finished the panel under Professor Aline's Osorio moderation. So now we are having Professor Phil Howard. He is in the room.
Welcome. Good to have you here. In what part of the world are you at right now?
At the moment, I'm in Victoria, British Columbia.
So that's Canada. Okay.
Exactly. Yes.
So, yeah. So it's noon here. You are one hour behind?
Exactly. 3 hours behind, but close enough in time zone.
Okay. 3 hours. Yeah, because you're more to the west. Okay. Yeah. Got it. Okay. You're more than welcome. We're very happy to have you. And we're going to start our panel, and I'll have to switch to Portuguese for a while. Okay. And you probably have translation button there, unless you speak Portuguese, Phil.
Not yet.
Okay. Muito bem. Muito boa tarde a todos.
Very good afternoon, everyone. We are beginning this afternoon, and we have the pleasure and honor to continue the second international seminar on disinformation and elections. Now, welcoming Professor Philip Howard, that is Yeah, directing here, I have the formal presentation of his. Philip Howard is a professor of Internet Studies on the Balliol College of University Oxford. He researches the impact of the digital media on political lives in all the world, and he's a frequent commentarist on media, global media, and political affairs. He's the author of a book that is a classic book, Lying Machines, How to Save Democracy from Troll Armies, Deceitful Robots, Junk News Operations, and Political Operatives, and many other books and economic papers. He has a graduation in science politics from the College University of Toronto. He's the doctor economic from the London School of Economics School, and also the doctor's degree in sociology for Northwest University. Philip, we have an honor, and we thank you for having you with us today, and the floor is all yours.
Thank you very much for having me today. It was an honor to hear a little bit about the previous panel, and I have several kinds of trends to talk to you about today. Maybe I'll speak for 20, 25 minutes, and then we can have a conversation or open it up for questions. I will start to share my screen and load up my presentation. My background, as Justice Barroso pointed out, I'm Canadian, live in the UK now, and I study how elections administration can be complicated by campaigns to undermine trust in public life. I've been working at the University of Oxford for several years, and so my goal today will be to tell you a little bit about the research that we've been doing, set some context with COVID-related misinformation, and offer some ideas for how to fix the big problems that we all face. Human rights, I think, are an important domain to study, because misinformation is perhaps one of the problems that can interfere with all other human rights. At the University of Oxford, we've been studying how misinformation has been involved in political campaigning for an extended period, and how it has transformed public machines. I'll introduce some of the global trends and then set some strategies for us. My particular research team has a goal of trying to improve civic engagement and solve public problems through social data science. We're a fairly large group, depending on the time of the year, the number of master's students and the doctoral students and faculty involved. We only work in countries where we have some language competence, and towards the end, during our questions, I'll share some of the research we've done on Brazil in 2018, and offer some of my favorite reports done by our colleagues, collaborators in Brazil, for the audience to explore later. The science of what we do has been National Science Foundation, and our public engagement activities are supported by the Ford Foundation. Now, this book, Lie Machines, was published a year ago, and although I'm very proud of it, because it's a book, it's already out of date in some ways. Unfortunately, the problem of misinformation moves so quickly. If you're a student, please send me an email. I will happily send you a free copy. Interested in this topic by the time I finish speaking, here's a discount code for the publisher's website. But again, if you're a student, please send me an email. I'll happily share the electronic version. Most of this book is about misinformation connected to the U.S. 2016 elections, the Brexit debate here in the UK, and several other prominent elections around the world, including some stories from Brazil. Several of the labs that produce misinformation we studied, one was based in Poland, the other one was based in Brazil. And I think since the book was published, we've all had to deal with several rounds of elections in our democracies, and the COVID crisis as fodder for misinformation. Certainly, the misinformation about COVID is one of the most complex misinformation operations I have ever seen. It involves stories about 5G cell phone towers, the cult of personality around Bill Gates, a very long-standing fear that the government is trying to put chips in our arms. And all of this is wrapped up now around a fairly middle-class movement of hesitancy around vaccination. And so it's become a very complex narrative that reaches quite far around the world and has quite serious implications for the risks we take as individuals. Several years ago, my team started producing an inventory of countries with active misinformation campaigns. In 2017, we found active information operations in almost 30 countries. Each year, unfortunately, the trend line is up. In our most recent report, there were well over 80 countries with active misinformation operations. And I mean these aren't lone wolf operations. These are formal organizations in the sociological sense, with receptionists and real estate and hiring plans. They have performance bonuses, they have retirement plans often, they pay their taxes as businesses. These are formal organizations. They have desks and telephones. Over time, the number of operations that are actually run by mainstream public relations firms has also increased. So early on, it used to be military units that were retasked to doing social media. Now it's PR firms in London, New York, Toronto. These are the firms that offer a suite of tools that many of us would call information operations or misinformation operations. We're at the point now where we may not run the study next year, because pretty much every country we look at has some form of information operating in public life. Last year we did a global study of risk perceptions. This was a study of 142 countries, a survey of 150,000 people around the world. We found that globally, disinformation is the single most important fear of internet media use. So more than half of the regular internet users identified disinformation as the thing they feared the most. We asked a range of questions. We asked about gender discrimination, credit card fraud. We asked about fear of AI, whether AI would take our jobs. Almost three quarters of internet users were worried about a mixture of these threats, including disinformation. And there were some very interesting regional differences. So in Latin America in particular, in Brazil, misinformation, disinformation is a high fear, but actually the fear of harassment, online harassment, was higher for women in particular across Latin America. These kinds of concerns vary by region and region. In Southeast Asia, the fear of disinformation was extremely low. So there's important variety around the world, but it's safe to say that on average, for most internet users globally, disinformation is one of the things that's most undermining trust in technology and trust in public life. Now, we've also done a focused look at how far COVID-related disinformation can travel, and it can be quite far. Most of the misinformation that comes out on COVID gets promoted by state-backed media agencies from Russia and China. And so in this chart, we track in a weekly, week to week, the kinds of stories produced by, in English, by major media outlets, CNN, The Times, and the BBC. We track the output of state-backed resources, and this is primarily Russia Today and CGTN. And then we track the pickup of news stories from junk health sites. These are websites just dedicated to producing misinformation on COVID. On a good day, unfortunately, a piece of misinformation from one of the state-backed media outlets can reach almost a billion social media user accounts. That especially happens if there's a prominent politician or a Hollywood star says something about health that gives one of these stories an extra kick. Now, in some ways, this is a very simple number. All we did was add up the number of YouTube users, the number of Reddit users, the number of Facebook users following these accounts. And in many weeks, a credible journalism does travel farther. But there are these moments where misinformation can reach quite far, quite deep into our social media networks. The other thing I'd like to talk a little bit about is not so much the content. Yeah, it's often easy to spot misinformation about COVID elections administration, but it's tougher to talk about how the stack, the technology stack, generates revenue for the technology firms. Big technology firms provide effectively the infrastructure for junk COVID news. They provide the website hosting services, the trackers that let you take a credit card, and many of these sites are after all, they're about generating revenue for their owners. So we did a specific study of websites that protest public health measures, such as lockdowns, websites that promote COVID-19 scams, fake cures, fraudulent cures, profiteering online, and websites that disseminate disinformation about public health. And then we're able to show how the major technology firms, even after they take down the content, yeah, this is the most public face of misinformation, but even after they take down the content, there are ways that Google, GoDaddy, and Cloudflare still provide the infrastructure support, the third-party technology services that track users across websites, follow them from a Facebook group to a website where you can pay the credit card to buy coconut milk, your fake cure for COVID. And these cross-platform integration tools are vital to hard, radical, conspiratorial groups. This infrastructure is often extraterritorial. So in our particular study, we found that 95% of the misinformation directed at US users on COVID was actually hosted on Cloudflare servers in Canada. Now, I'm still trying to investigate why. I don't fully understand why this content would have been would reside in Canada. And I suspect that the Canadian government has some obligation, some duty under international law to protect the citizens of other countries, perhaps by acting against this hosting. But much of the content, unfortunately, that we face in disinformation isn't even hosted in our own country. Now let me talk about strategies, because in some sense, we've had 5 or 6 years of constant updates about the latest misinformation trends about attacks on our election systems. What can we actually do about it? I think there's several things we can do to improve the global information environment, and certainly during moments of elections. In the book, I go into several of the more abstract principles here. I think it should be possible to train social media algorithms with high quality data that is fresh, that has been gathered with user consent, that has been cleaned as much as possible of the biases that we know other algorithms have been trained on. There's an idea about having the ultimate beneficiary reported by our technologies. And this is something I borrowed from the Blood Diamonds campaign of 20 years ago. You may remember this was an interesting initiative to teach diamond consumers before they buy their wedding rings where in the world the diamond comes from. And the hope was that if the diamond was marked as coming from the nastiest pit of mining in Africa, most consumers around the world would not buy this diamond. I think we should be able to look at any one of our technology devices and ask it to tell us who is benefiting, who is using our data. Right now, our smartphones, our smart refrigerators can't even do this. The firms that manufacture these technologies don't know who has paid for the data and is reusing it in different ways. being able to understand which political party has bought our data, which social movements are making use of our data, I think is a fundamental to modern citizenship. Because the next step, the ability to donate data, to give our data to our favorite political parties, our COVID health researchers, this is a form of civic expression now, I think, in the modern digital environment that many of us do not have. It is very difficult to donate our data to the causes that we believe in. I think having infrastructure that tithes is very important, and Brazil has led in this in many ways, providing infrastructure for civil society groups, the Marco Civil. There's a long history of Brazilian leadership in the civic face of internet technologies. One of the few rules, one of the few things we can learn from the United States on governing data is this rule that the US government has about not profiting from the sale of data about our party affiliation. There are very few rules that regulate data mining in the US, but one of them is that if you register to vote, a firm can take that data from the government and merge other variables with it, but they're not supposed to profit by selling that public interest variable. There are many ways they get around this, but the concept is interesting. There should be a set of variables related to public health, related to basic demographics, the kinds of things we collect in a census, that a firm should not be allowed to profit from in reselling. This would carve out a domain of data that would be valuable to researchers around the world. I think we're at this key deep question now for human rights. Do we have a right to truth? Do we have a right to high quality information? I think the answer is yes, but this is an assertion more than anything. It's more of an assumption for many theories. The theory of deliberative democracy, the theory that elections work, lies, is strengthened by the idea that we have a claim on some truths. We can't deliberate well. Our politicians can't make good decisions if they don't have access to evidence and accurate information. For the policy challenges we all face, for the operational exercise of voting, in those days before voters choose, they need access to high quality information. Now, I study politics, but I'm very realistic. Most of the time, most people around the world don't use social media for politics. Yeah, politics is not one of the things they think about. But in those 3 days before people vote, that is the critical moment where the major social media firms serve up large amounts of misinformation. And that's when the political scientists tell us most voters make up their mind. Most voters decide who they'll vote for in those few days before the election is held. Right now, misinformation is the means through which racial, gender, and religious discrimination occurs. Extremism and violence is stimulated, condoned, or ignored. Now, one of the concepts I'm increasingly behind is this notion of creating an intergovernmental panel on the information environment. Like the IPCC, so the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, this could be a body that would coordinate the science, make directed global requests of social media firms, track the global trends, engage in many different kinds of stakeholders, certainly involving citizens, identify the best practices for protecting elections and protect from misinformation, and share those best practices across countries. I think an IPIE at the international level could coordinate this research, promote information access, and share best practices in a significant and regularized way. For my own team in Oxford, I'll just wind up with a few thoughts on what we'll be doing for the year, the academic year ahead. We'll be spending more time on COVID misinformation, and we have a newsletter that I'm happy to, I'll drop into the chat the information for how to sign up on the weekly, the bi-weekly trends on global COVID misinformation. We'll be spending more time tracking information operations launched by the PRC. We've just done a major report on the impact of misinformation on children with UNICEF, and I think this is one of the big research questions we don't know how to answer. Many of us have studied the impact of disinformation, misinformation on adults, on adult voters. What about next year's voters? What about the people, the citizens, who are 12 to 18 now, who are developing their political identities now in this environment, what impact will misinformation have on their political identities? I think it's an open question that is worth some investigation. We also have a series of trainings that we offer now for civil society groups on how to respond if they get targeted by an information operation. We offered one in São Paulo about 2 years ago and would be happy to help organize another one, perhaps the time to visit Rio or another capital in the next year or so. I think trying to figure out the international response to misinformation is one of the grand challenges for us. It's pretty clear this is a global problem. The technology firms do not respond to individual governments. Coordinated questions and coordinated demands are probably the way to proceed. I'll end with this. I'm sorry, Jeannie, your answer was correct, but Kevin shouted his incorrect answer over yours, so he gets the point. This game is not the world I want to live in. We've been studying disinformation now for 5 or 6 years, and I think we're operating on the fumes of hope. We don't think it's too late to change. I'm cynical, but not fatalistic. Yeah, I do think it's possible to reconstruct the information environment for those of us living in democracies. I do think it's possible to use social media in constructive ways for public life. But it's going to take some concerted effort, pulling in the right direction together to pull that off. I'll stop sharing my screen now, and I'll look forward to the conversation. I've got several links I can drop into the chat. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you very much, Phil. It was so good that it seemed very quick. But we all wanted more. I'm going to switch to Portuguese, if I may. Muitíssimo obrigado pela sua
participação. Thank you so much, Philip, for your participation and for the important reflections you have brought to us over this topic that has concerned all of the countries, democratic countries around the world nowadays. And I remember that when internet started, Philip, the speech or the discourse was that it should be open, free, and unregulated. And throughout time, we were noticing that, well, unfortunately, that could not be the best way, that it would be needed to regulate the internet and economical issues to avoid the market dominations and antitrust. And we also noticed that we had lots of risks for privacy afterwards. And now we notice that even the content demands some kind of control to avoid that the social media become ways to create a kind of criminality or something like terrorism, pedophilia, or that disinformation could commit also severely our democracy. We here in Brazil, we tackled this problem in the Superior Electoral Court in our last year's election. And a comment that I would like to make, and I would like to hear a little bit from you, and we had the news of the Facebook papers, but in the 2018 elections, I was vice president of TSE, Electoral Supreme Court, and the social media were more they're more favorable to a deep collaboration to avoid and prevent the inauthentic behaviors, and even more, to remove content and delete content. And in 2020, in the last elections that I presided, with a coordination with Aline, we set partnerships with all the main social media, Instagram, Facebook, Google, Twitter, TikTok, and all of those social media were available, and they were really willing to remove a large amount of accounts that have inauthentic behavior and a large amount of fake news about the credibility of the election system.
But the last information from Facebook Papers suggests that we need to do much more than that. Right now, in this moment in Brazil, we are in a regulation context for the social media. The Senate has already approved a bill that is being discussed in the House of Representatives in advanced discussions already. I already received the proposal that will be debated in the House of Representatives. But I didn't have the chance to read it yet. But I would like to hear from you a little bit more about regulatory models. State regulation, self-regulation, regulated regulation. But what do you imagine that the future is reserving to us in terms of regulation? Remembering that Brazil is a country that we have a lot of fear from the government interference over freedom of speech. We are going through my generation experience a long dictatorship, and the fear of my generation is the state censorship. And we don't want private censorship either. But we do not want junk on the social media as well. So we are all fighting for this balance tipping point. So I would like to hear from you, your observation around what the world has been practicing, what the world has been doing on the regulation models, and what has your greatest sympathy.
Wonderful. Thank you for this question.
Wow, maravilhoso. Muito obrigado por essa pergunta. E nós temos muitas ideias boas.
Perhaps let me start by saying that I believe we are past the point of industry self-regulation. I don't think industry self-regulation is a viable option at this moment. And in fact, the heads of most of the major technology firms, including Facebook, have asked for regulatory guidance. They've signaled quite clearly that they would like some rules that they can design to. Now, the European Commission's response to this is to have a code of conduct that they hold the firms to. And then they listen to civil society and industry for guides on whether the firms are fitting the code of conduct. I think several of us have argued that the firms have not abided by the code of conduct, and the European Commission has not done very much about it. So one of the light ways of moving forward is to draft a code of conduct that you would expect the firms to act to and find some ways to hold them to it. I think your instinct about censorship is absolutely right, and I fully agree. There's sort of two buckets of policy options. One involves content regulations, either by government or by courts. Yeah, the French system is to give it to judges who evaluate truth. There's that system that involves, or private content regulation by the heads of the firms, perhaps. Then there's a bucket of policy responses that are market-led, and these involve antitrust action or fines, perhaps even redirecting revenue to the professional journalists who have lost so much revenue to the social media platforms. And my preference is to draw from that toolkit. So among the best ideas out there, Australia and Canada have both experimented with forms of tax and revenue, treating the social media firms as publishers, and then taking some of the significant ad revenue that the firms generate and giving back to civic journalism, to independent investigators. I think there are a family of immediate policy guidelines, such as that revenue redirection. There is also a family of electoral laws that most democracies already have on the books. But looking around at many democracies, we find that elections administrators are often underfunded, or they don't have the power to fine, or they have good technical capacity, but don't have the ability to punish politicians who abuse the rules. And so the second thing we can do is staff our elections administrators well. In most democracies, these are technocrats. These are not elected positions who do the administration of an election. making sure that an elections administration has the ability to access, do research, has good staff resources, and can actually follow through on the rules that are already on the books is very critical. I think the third possibility involves having political parties provide, take access to the technology firms through direct and local offices. So most of the major social media platforms don't have a policy person in each national capital. But in those critical moments of an election, if somebody is being attacked unfairly, if there's a massive neo-Nazi campaign against a particular candidate, the parties need to be able to call the engineers in Facebook, the engineers in WhatsApp, to identify a campaign directly, to deal something with something quickly while it's flowing across social media. And you and I have spoken so much about Twitter and Facebook. I think we also need to speak a fair amount about WhatsApp, which is extremely important in the Brazilian context. Yeah? This is a platform that that describes itself as a personal messaging app, but many political figures treat it as a broadcast app. Yeah? They distribute large amounts of content over many, many, many WhatsApp groups. We did a study, not of Brazil, but of India and Mexico during their elections, of how WhatsApp was used. And there was a good finding and a not very good finding. The not very good finding was that the WhatsApp groups are actually the worst of all the social media types in terms of the extremism, the conspiratorial, the sensationalist stories, often mixed with pornography. It is the real dreck that flows off in many of those small political WhatsApp groups. The good news is that most people don't share that kind of content outside of the WhatsApp groups. So political communications professionals do use them to organize their diehard followers, to distribute the nastiest of political rhetoric. But that content does not tend to flow out into the broader public. Now, this may change. There's so many things that change year to year. On the whole, we do need to spend time thinking about these private messaging apps like WhatsApp. They probably should be in scope, just like Facebook and Twitter and Reddit.
Okay. You probably know that Aline, I wonder if we should do this in Portuguese, right? Deveria mudar para português,
né? I can pick up on the translation. Yes, I'm happy to.
Yeah, so let's switch.
Sim, posso.
In Portuguese.
Okay. So probably you will know, Phil. Okay, can you hear the translation? All right, you know that probably here in Brazil, well, according to the last researches that we have news from, 79% of the Brazilians, 79%, receive their information via WhatsApp. I have the statistics here to share with you, but I myself was shocked, surprised. 79% via WhatsApp. 50%, 50% by TV, 49% by YouTube, and 44% from Facebook. And we who are the old-fashioned, we read the newspapers, 8% only. Only 8% of people are informed by newspapers. And I am just making this comment to confirm what you have just told us about the importance of these apps that are said messaging apps, but they are the main source of information. I'd like to hear from you, Philip, before we close, and enjoy this pleasure of having you here with us and the privilege to have you here with us. We have two models, main models maybe, of accountability in the platforms.
liability in the platforms. We have a model that I believe that prevails or has the trend to prevail in Europe, which is the model where when there's a notification by the interested part, the content must be removed or at least analyzed with a possibility of punishment for the platform. And the model that we chose here in Brazil, which is a model that the platform is only forced to remove the content after a judicial decision.
Pelo que eu tenho notícia, mas não confirmei, os dados dos Unidos não apresentam de ordem judicial determinação, remoção. Portanto, temos um modelo que basta a notificação, um modelo que depende de ordem judicial, e um modelo que depende de ordem judicial, porque só as plataformas, porque o judiciário não interfere. Gostaria de ouvir sobre esses modelos e se você tem alguma preferência que queira manifestar.
Thank you. The translation stopped just for the last 10 seconds, but I think I got it. This is a stunning figure for WhatsApp in Brazil that I did not know. I think there are at least two, possibly three easy things that regulators can do, and certainly that WhatsApp would be could be subject to. The first is data sharing with researchers. The best data on public problems is not in the national library. It's not with the medical doctors in the country. It's not with researchers. It's in Silicon Valley. And in order to understand public problems, it is critical that social media firms be expected to share with independent journalists, with civil society, in privacy-respecting ways, yeah, in ways that respect the users of privacy and the intellectual property of the firm. But right now, they do not share at all. And I put into the link a wonderful study from Internet Lab Brazil about how Brazilians use WhatsApp. This is a very good report to read. Their team and our team, we have to struggle to get data to be able to provide good reports to legislators. And senates and parliaments around the world very rarely get access to high quality data about what's going on. So requiring that firms share data is critical. The other thing that comes to mind listening to you speak about WhatsApp is that most of the social media firms do provide some public education, some get out the vote campaigns, some public service ads on their platforms. They do this occasionally and in a haphazard way. I think it would be reasonable to expect that social media firms, including WhatsApp, do good education for their users, alert people about where their polling booth is, about what the elections rules are. Brazil is unique in having a very special kind of ballot and in having a lot of mail-in voting at election time. But expecting WhatsApp to disseminate the good rules that are in place for elections administration, I think this is quite a reasonable thing to expect of our social media platforms. The long-term investment certainly has to be education. Yeah? Over time, we need people to grow up with new media, with new information habits. You and I may read the newspapers until our very last days, but the next generation of voters need to be savvy with their technologies. And this means public investment in media education at the school level. I think it also means expecting Facebook and YouTube and Twitter and WhatsApp to invest in the education of their own users. Now, how we enforce that may vary from country to country, but campaigning to around election time to disseminate the rules and guidelines for how to participate in an election this, I think, is an obligation we can put at the feet of social media firms like WhatsApp.
You know, as I'll say it in English, as for the liability of the platforms, I think there are basically two models. The one that I assume is used in Europe, that you ought to remove the post once the interested party has notified the platform that there's something wrong with it. And you have the other model that I think we adopt, that we adopt in Brazil, which is you need a court order for removal and you're not liable until a court order is issued. And from what I understand, although I didn't really check myself, I think in the US, there has been no court order for removal of content. So I think that you have two or three models, maybe. And I would like to hear from you if you think any of them is better and what would your preference be?
I think my preference would be for a combined model. The court order process is not fast enough for some of the damages that can occur, especially in the 48 hours before people vote or the last days of an election. The court order process is useful for teaching the firms what norms or what standards they might be held to over the long course. In countries where there aren't the court, and the Philippines is another country that does the court order model, I think that's a purposeful choice, right, to keep the process slow. In other countries, the social media firms invest themselves in community juries, almost, that evaluate content, and they publish their community standards. They have their own internal juries that will make quick decisions about content for major moments, at major moments, such as suspending Trump's Twitter account. There is an extensive internal conversation, although there are many pundits who would say that that decision took too long. Right, that there are many political figures who are violating the terms of service of the platforms. And as the Facebook whistleblower has shown us, the platforms know that this is so and are choosing not to act in a timely way. So I think a healthy path for Brazil might be to maintain the court order process, right, so that there's a clear signaling about what the norms are, but then also have expect the firms to be much more responsive. There are a number of international courts. There's a court of arbitration in sport and an anti-doping court in Lausanne that are designed to give very rapid decisions, right? These are arbitral bodies. They work in 24 hours or less. It may be possible to develop a hybrid court in cooperation with the firms, with their investment, that would allow for very rapid decisions on particular kinds of content. You're the legal expert. It's difficult for me to imagine how that could be set up. But I would say the best is probably a hybrid, the long durée of court judicial review, and then the rapid response mechanism that is transparent and credible.
Great. Muchíssimo obrigado, Phil.
Thank you very much, Phil. We are about to finish, and I'd like to thank you for all your remarks that are extremely interesting and important and relevant and help us to illuminate this topic that for this moment is mobilizing parliamentarians, professors, judges all over the world. And we are all trying to find this balance to preserve the freedom of speech, to preserve the free initiative, the platforms, and also to protect the public interest, especially on episode contents and sensitive content. So it's fascinating. It's concerning on one side, but it's fascinating on the other side, where we try to combine all the progress benefits of the internet with the risks as side effects that we need to be prepared to manage. Thank you very much. I hope to see you soon. in November, I will be in Cambridge. Maybe if we can, it'd be a pleasure to be with you. I'll let you know. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Over Canada.
And we hope that after the pandemic, we can welcome you here in Brazil in person in some time in the future. Thank you. And so, Alina, declared this session of the seminar finished, inviting everyone to get back at 2 p.m. with the panel on how to tackle electoral disinformation. Thank you, everyone, and see you in the afternoon session. See you.